So what we want to do this morning is start with kind of the big picture, kind of the basic concepts about winter cities. And we've invited one of my colleagues from Edmonton, Simon O'Byrne, who is a vice president and heads up our urban planning group in Canada and is very involved in the United States as well. Simon was the co-chair of the Winter Cities Conference in Edmonton a couple years ago and has continued to be very active in Winter Cities issues. So Simon's going to kind of set the stage, kind of talk about what's been done in Edmonton, bring in some other international examples. He's an urban designer with a lot of passion, and he talks about placemaking and how you deal with climate and so forth. The other kind of big picture idea will be my colleague Jim Mayland. And Jim has really been an innovator in water and ice. He's been working with aquatics and ice for several years now. And he's going to share with you lots of great examples of the use of water and ice, and as you can see from the kind of weather we're having right now, the importance of refrigeration to actually make the seasons work in terms of being able to stretch the seasons. Jim is probably the foremost expert on that and has a lot of great projects to share. We're then going to take Q&A from the group, and we will be facilitating that with two people walking out into the audience with a microphone. And then we have an action-packed second half where we talk about, Carol Hell will talk about Metro Transit and how winter affects our transit service in the Twin Cities and things, strategies, ideas that are being used now to try and mitigate some of those concerns and make transit more robust. Max Musicant and John Peterson will also talk about placemaking, and they've got some great examples as well of ways in which you can bring fire and shelter and other things to the winter environment, and talk about saunaing outside with your friends. Kurt Wayne from the City of Minneapolis will also talk about the whole idea of winter infrastructure for bikes and pedestrians, and talk about the work that they have done and the work that's being done other places and the study that's underway right now to try and find ways to make bicycle and pedestrian transit better. And then Ben Shardlow from the Minneapolis DID will talk about Minneapolis and how Minneapolis is moving toward Winter City. So with that, and in reliance on hope, I'm going to call on Simon O'Byrne, and Simon is going to talk to us about Winter Cities and share the Edmonton example and his perspective as an urban planner.
Good morning and welcome, everyone. Thank you very much for being here and listening in. I've been co-chairing the City of Edmonton's Winter City Strategy for the past 5+ years. And one of the big focuses we've had as a winter city is for too long, we simply gave a cursory kind of attention to wintertime, even though it was our longest season. And we simply kind of hibernated far too much. And we didn't embrace winter life in winter city design. And we didn't do things like embrace winter festivals adequately. And so what we've tried to do is have a grassroots movement to get a lot of Edmontonians involved in thinking about winter in their city. One of the things that Edmonton's tried to do is think of everything as relates to winter. Our bylaws, our policies in the City of Edmonton, how we actually encourage further business in wintertime. So for example, when you're working with people in terms of commercial environments, for example, as it relates to TOD, one of the key things is to ask, have you done a performa based on 8 months or based on 12 months? If you're not thinking adequately about winter, you should really do a performa really for 8 months of activity, and because if you're not thinking about winter, then you really can't be truly thinking about a 12-month performa. The City of Edmonton recently just adopted Winter City Design Guidelines, and these are available for you to downline and crib and borrow, and please use them as you see fit. There's a lot of really good ideas that we kind of worked on in-house. I'm not going to say that we didn't certainly do a lot of extensive research throughout North America, throughout Northern Europe. We did trips to Northern Europe, and we talked to a lot of people there. We even talked to jurisdictions as far away as Sapporo, Japan, and Mongolia, and Iceland to get input as well. So we had a really wide cross-section of best practices, and we kind of took them, and we tried to make them native to Edmonton. So So if you go to the City of Edmonton website for Winter City, you'll find videos on here, you'll find all kinds of information that's really trying hard to make Edmonton a lot more Winter City-centric. Santec as a company has worked on Winter City design, both in terms of how we think about architecture, how we think about things like freezeways or iceways, how we think about the built form so it's more comfortable. Part of Winter City thinking is really trying to have a huge shift in terms of the culture. For too long, we've had an attitude which was, we kind of, like I said, kind of rejected it, hibernated. And what we often did was we said, well, what's the closest I can get my car to the door by which I'm going to go in, and what's the least amount of clothing I can wear based on that distance I'm going to have to walk from where I park and where I go in. And so we really kind of, as opposed to dressing to be outside for longer periods of time, we kind of dress grossly inadequately. So there's a whole mentality change about how we dress for winter, how we build our cities for winter. And many cities obviously do a really poor job thinking about winter. When they think about winter, they simply think it's all about snow, what's your snow clearing policy in terms of the plows and how many inches of snow should they leave on the ground and the cost of snow clearing. And they give it really a really pathetic attempt at kind of tackling winter. But when you think of Minnesota and you think of Canada and you think of many parts of North America that have one of their longest seasons and most potent seasons is winter, it's so incumbent on us to really kind of embrace it differently. So winter design in a nutshell is really comes down to five key things. Blocking out the wind, because it could be just a little bit below freezing or quite a bit below freezing, but if there's no wind and the sun is on your face, it can feel really comfortable to be outside. But if it's below freezing and there is a wind and you're in the shade, it feels horrible and it's so uncomfortable to be a pedestrian. And you cannot think about transit-oriented development if you can't think about pedestrians, because every transit trip begins and ends as a pedestrian. So you cannot become a successful TOD if it is not a successful four-season pedestrian environment, which is so important. And why so many TODs in northern climates fail, because we don't adequately address all four seasons in terms of design. The other key aspect is about capturing sunshine and putting people in it, using color, because too often we embrace colors that actually make us feel colder and darker and don't feel warm to us, embracing lighting and thinking about infrastructure differently. And so part of this starts at the neighborhood level. We know that in most places, like Minnesota, the worst wind comes from the north and the northwest. So if we can do neighborhood design and you think about brand new suburban TUDs, if you can, when you have to do the grading of the land and you build up the grades for storm ponds and for other things, as much as we can, we need to kind of pile the snow in the north to northwest part of these sites. We need to put coniferous trees on those embankments, because those kind of mitigate the wind in a big deal. Part of it also means thinking about the street layout differently. Curvilinear streets are not TOD friendly and they're not Winter City friendly. In winter times, we want to make sure that people can be comfortable walking outside, but we don't have an environment in wintertime where we want to unduly add 2 minutes or 5 minutes or 10 minutes to somebody's walk because we have a curvilinear design. We need shorter grid environments so it's much more convenient, intuitive, and comfortable to walk a shorter distance. Part of this is very much about blocking wind, and there's all kinds of different vehicles that can be used in terms of the urban design to block wind, but it's critical. You can use setbacks, you can use colonnades, you can use canvas canopies to kind of redirect the wind away from pedestrians. You can also use landscaping, and landscaping is a great vehicle, but it has to mean either taller bushes and windrows. You have to think about coniferous trees and things like that. They're really going to help mute the wind a little bit and kind of take out some of the velocity. The Aqua Tower in Chicago is an 80-plus story tower, and if you've been at the base of it, surprisingly, even though it's adjacent to Lake Michigan, it's really not that windy at the base of the building. And so the design of the building took in mind how the wind, it modeled the wind very successfully. So as the wind hits the building and it kind of goes down, it's shaped in such a way that it really successfully takes out, diffuses the energy in the wind so that as a pedestrian ground level, you really don't feel windy. In fact, the wind you're feeling at ground level, if there's any, is from other buildings that have done a miserable job about blocking out the wind. Whereas the Aqua Tower, which is I believe it's still the tallest building in the world designed by a female architect, did a brilliant job of modeling out and designing out the wind. A lot of this is also about capturing sunshine and putting people in sunlight as much as possible. So that means thinking about sun traps. And also thinking about the shape of the street. So when we're doing laying out TUDs and we're laying out development, what are the opportunities so that we can actually turn the streets so that every side of the street is going to get some amount of sun in winter time? And we have to think very hard about the modeling of winter. Too often when we're doing sunlight shadow studies, we're usually doing them from the equinox to equinox, and we're almost writing off winter saying, well, it doesn't get that high of the horizon, and so it's really tough to avoid sunlight shadow impacts in winter time. Well, that's not adequate thinking. I think we have to really think about how we put as much sun as possible into the public realm and do four-season modeling of sunlight shadow studies. That also means that we start thinking about the location of taller buildings, that we have to have a lot of care and attention because the cumulative effects of multiple buildings in close order can really mean that an area for 4 months of the year can be effectively in darkness and perpetuity. And that, to me, is hostile towards creating a successful pedestrian environment, hostile towards encouraging more retail and commercial activity, and which is what we really want, which is a lot of local business development. Microclimates are also really critical, and this means thinking about, again, maximizing the sun in every way possible. So locating the trees in a way that so that they're on the north side, they're kind of on the north side of walkways, again, building on sun traps, and using color. It shocks me sometimes when I see how much architects who are disproportionately male do not adequately think about warmth and how do we create really charming and warm environments. In wintertime, that's so important. So we see a lot of gray and a lot of steel, a lot of glass. And to me, those are things that accentuate the cold as opposed to the opposite. So we need to use more wood as building materials, embrace color, and have some fun with it. We also need to use creative lighting. We've got wonderful palette of darkness for almost 6 months of the year. And we know in Minnesota, as in most places, there's a lot of boring, drab architecture that's just begging for some creative lighting to be displayed on the side of the building. We can do that. We can embrace lighting. We can embrace our public parks and use landscape lighting to add interest to our public parks. We can think about nightscaping for everything from our public art to how we add interest to buildings. So it could be very obvious stuff like architectural lighting on a heritage building that lights up a cornice and different details and moldings. However, it's really about thinking about what are all the opportunities where there's a blank facade where we can embrace nightscaping, which is architectural landscape lighting. The use of light is so critical when we think about the opportunities for TUD. How do we make these places safer, more interesting? So as we're walking as a pedestrian in a TUD environment, how do we make these places feel a lot more interesting to us? And safety is a real big part of it. If we can get more people walking around in a TUD, then they're going to feel a lot more safe. And there's such wonderful opportunities with our palette of darkness here. And so one of the big things is also heritage buildings. I spoke about this really quickly, but If there is any typology of building that begs for architectural lighting, it is heritage buildings. And they're such great opportunities because they just so well lend themselves towards lighting, and that can dramatically enhance the sense of place. Infrastructure is also very important, and this means things like infrastructure around winter cycling. And just quickly, the story of Copenhagen. So Copenhagen in 1970 came very close to banning bikes in Copenhagen. So I think it was about 1970, 71, the city council in Copenhagen was so worried about traffic flow through the city center that they came very close to voting to ban bikes through Copenhagen because they wanted to increase the capacity of the roads and bikes were taking away from capacity for cars. Thankfully, they voted the right way and the progressive way, and they made the decision that they really wanted to double down on bikes. So starting in the 1970s, they started thinking about building protective bike lanes. And some years, they had a little bit of money, and they just built a mile or two of protective bike lanes. Some years, when they had more money in their city budget, they added tens of miles of bike lanes. The cumulative effects is that a generation later, they've got 400 miles of protective bike lanes in and around Copenhagen. And they passed a very important milestone a couple of years ago, I think it was about 2 years ago, where 50% of all trips through Copenhagen are done by bike. That doesn't include pedestrians or transit. 50% of all trips are done through bike in a place that was so auto-centric in the early 70s that City Hall nearly voted to ban bikes. And so the point here is about relentless progress, having a bold vision to transform an area, but you cannot achieve that kind of transformation if you don't think about change in winter in the Copenhagen. That means, and these images, by the way, are from Copenhagen. People ride bikes in Copenhagen even when it looks like this. Copenhagen is a city that gets 20 average days a month of either rain, snow, or sleet. 20 days a month, year-round, they average rain, snow, or sleet. And despite that miserable weather, they also get 50% of all trips by bike, which is phenomenal. That means thinking about how do we kind of have conversations about bikes, how do we provide protective bike lanes. In a winter city context, it is not adequate to simply put down a strip of paint. We need to have proper protective bike lanes because there's too much grit on the roads, too much salt on the roads, and we need to have further barriers that apply that 880 principle so that whether you're 80 years old or 8 years old, you feel comfortable cycling on a road next to a bus. But you need to have some kind of barrier that's going to separate you from that bus and from that vehicle. Otherwise, you're not going to feel safe, especially in a winter context when you know a bike or vehicle can slip. That's why you cannot have a successful winter cycling city if you don't think about protection for in wintertime. This also means about bicycle storage and making sure that that's comfortable and intuitive and available. Bicycle routes and storage are critical. And also thinking about the infrastructure around with our frequent changes in weather where we get these schizophrenic environments where 1 week it's 50 degrees and the next week it's 0 degrees. And when you get those swings, you get these freeze-thaw cycles. And so we constantly get pooling of water happening in intersections. And when we realize that depending on the community, anywhere from one-third to one-quarter of our populations by the 2030s are going to be senior citizens. That means we must be planning today for a society with reduced mobility. And you cannot have successful winter cities if we don't start thinking about how infrastructure performs, not just in summer when we have a storm, but in spring thaw cycles so that it's very comfortable to cross streets. You think about somebody who's in a wheelchair or uses a walker like my 84-year-old dad, and these barriers to walking around as a pedestrian are horrible if we don't drain properly. And we need to think about infrastructure differently and design intersections quite a bit differently so they're safer. That means changing in terms of the distances we have to go to cross the street, putting in more pedestrian refuges, more curb bulb outs as well so that pedestrians have a smaller distance to walk. We also have to think about pedways, and Minneapolis St. Paul is one of the largest collections of plus 15s in the world. But the problem with the plus 15 system is that you really rob the street life by putting everything at plus 15. And the danger you do that is that the pedways can accelerate the wind, so you end up taking what is a bad problem, which is about taking street life and putting it up 15 feet. And you can exasperate it and make it worse by actually amplifying the wind through pedways at the ground level. So you've robbed street life, and you take away, and you amplify the wind, which makes for a much more uncomfortable environment for pedestrians. So these things kind of compound a problem. This kind of slide shows you kind of a collage of all the different ideas that you can do in terms of how you design roofs to mitigate out the wind, heating shelters, how you use canopies, towers, designs, podium, deciduous trees, and all these different, or coniferous trees, all these different things you can do to make for a much more successful public space and public realm in wintertime. That means also thinking about the pedestrians, and what's really critical is too many streets, as I've walked around places in Minnesota, too many places have not provided adequate protection for pedestrians. It's not just also about redirecting the wind away from pedestrians. It's also providing protection from people in terms of icicles falling and rain coming down. We need to provide those protections. That also means thinking about bus shelters differently. How can they be warmer and more interesting? Building height and placement so that we're not unduly impacting other properties by having shadow impacts in wintertime, and being very deliberate about where we put the public spaces in the building for the four seasons. Roofs are really critical. It was shocking to me when I went to, I guess maybe not shocking to me, when I walked around the MIT campus a couple of years ago and I saw a very handsome Frank Gehry building. And of course, this architect comes in, designs this, interesting building on the MIT campus, but six of the eight entrances to the building, it was February, six of the eight entrances to the Frank Gehry building on the MIT campus were closed because Frank Gehry didn't think at all about snow and ice in Boston. And to me, it's shocking that in Boston and Cambridge that somebody would ever think about how is this building going to perform in wintertime. Well, Frank Gehry didn't adequately think about that, and as a result, they had a horrible problem with falling snow and ice, and so it wasn't safe. So six of eight entrances had to be closed. Too often, we don't think about roofs and how they're kind of mitigating the snow and ice, and again, creating a much more pedestrian-friendly environment. If people have to worry about ice dripping off, liquid dripping off, and then freezing when it hits the ground, or snow or ice falling. Again, these are barriers that prevent having a successful pedestrian environment. Building setbacks and varying the setbacks so that we're again mitigating the wind, and we're also providing opportunities for people to have more sun traps are really critical. And terracing of buildings is an easy way to kind of mitigate the wind, because when we terrace the building, we're giving more people opportunities for sun, and we're providing more diffusion of wind before it hits the pedestrian level. Pocket space is really critical, and this is really good winter city design. So winter cities, if we can create these little pocket spaces where they're oriented towards the south, and that's where we put our cafes, that's where we kind of put our hyper investment in a really great, smart public realm that's really thoughtful, where we really want to get as much people watching as possible. The vehicle to do that is these little pocket spaces that embrace the sun. And the building massing and stepping is really critical. That means thinking about both slender towers as much as possible and getting away from big slab designs. So that means we want as much as possible. We want to really discourage buildings that are more than 7,500 square foot floor plates unless they've adequately thought about how they're going to mitigate the wind. And building design, again, I talked about use of wood, but you see the warmth that's used when you use wood as a material, and you use color, and you use glazing in a way that's winter city centric. And really, the outcome we want to get to in a lot of this is about creating delight for pedestrians. That means the shelter, that means the canvas canopies and colonnades, and creating in public spaces. Always think about the production and enhancement of the pedestrian realm. Building entrances, so embracing glass panels, again, to add some interest, and to also think about the entrances of building, how comfortable are they in inviting? And also thinking about the indoor and outdoor relationships. Are we putting enough glazing at ground floor, or is there way too much solid material at ground floor? And what's so important, I always say to our clients, if you only have $100 to spend on your facade, spend 85 of those $100 on the first 30 feet of the building, because that's the most critical that's the most critical part of the building in terms of the urban design. And if you can nail that first 30 feet, you're going to have a much more successful development, a much more aesthetically pleasing one. And you need to focus on having a lot of glazing. The majority of that 30 feet needs to have a lot of glazing in it, so that you have way more transparency and way more of a connectivity between what's happening inside the building and the public realm, to create those people watching opportunities and create more more interest. Again, aesthetics is really critical, and adequately thinking about this, not just in the summertime, but in the wintertime. And street furniture. Too often we think about street furniture, and we think about it as though every day is July 1st, and it's green, and it's really charming and warm outside. And what we don't think about is, how does the street furniture perform when there's 2 feet of snow on the ground? Does the street furniture sit a little higher up so your feet can dangle down a little bit in the summer, but in wintertime, your feet are sitting on snow that's kind of packed down a little bit? Are we thinking about that? Are we also thinking about how drainage works when we've got snow and ice that might accumulate on these benches? So as much as possible, using wooden benches because of how they perform, and using slats in the wooden benches so we get proper drainage. If we don't think about these things, then they're not going to be used for all four seasons. And also having boulevard trees are really critical. Boulevard trees are really critical because it, A, provides us a place to put snow. Two, it provides a buffer from the pedestrian, from the vehicle realm, which is really critical, because too often we don't provide boulevards. When a bus goes by or a car goes by, pedestrians are constantly getting splashed with that ugly, brown, dirty water. And so if we don't provide boulevards and with trees in them, then we've got no place to put the snow. And when we get melt, we're going to be constantly splashing pedestrians. And again, it's yet another reason why we are another barrier to walking and being a successful pedestrian environment, which is so critical if we're going to have a successful TOD. Transit shelters, and thinking about them is important, adequate, and so critical. And wayfinding. We think about wayfinding, and we put up signs. We don't think about the performance of those signs for all four seasons. We need to think about how we're using light and wayfinding, and we can have fun with light. We can think about light as something that could be used whimsical in a fun way. And we can use light in such a way that it can add way more interest in terms of wayfinding, and it can actually be seen for the 6 months of the year where it's disproportionately dark. We can also use shelters and warming huts in our public spaces and have a little fun with them, architectural competitions for them, and snow fences as well, so that we're stopping the wind and the snow pileup. And then the residential buildings, coming up with design guidelines for them that are more inviting in wintertime. And the parks and plazas and interfaces them. Are we thinking about what we're going to do with the blank spaces? And every city has got blank spaces, whether it's a tired retail space where there's a long-standing for lease sign, where there's a parking lot there that's underutilized after business hours. Are we thinking about how do we animate those spaces so that something's happening there, so that they're safer, more comfortable to be in for all four seasons? On site layout and planning, one of the things I wanted to talk about is it's so critical to lay out buildings, and when we do design of park spaces and our public realms, to be thinking about the wind and sun. And when we start thinking about a normal kind of SHRET process, we usually start with talking about what are the constraints, and then we get into the opportunities. But one of the constraints we have to be thinking of is, what is happening in the space with the wind, and what's happening in the space with the sun? And it's incumbent on us as planners and people and designers and engineers to be thinking about these things. And the planting of vegetation that can be used so that we're putting berms where they can add comfort for pedestrians as well. And other infrastructure such as seating for people and fire protection and recreation opportunities. One of the things that was really interesting when you go to places like Oslo and Helsinki is that on their light rail lines, it's not uncommon for people to bring their fat bikes and to bring their cross-country skis onto the LRTs. So are we actually thinking about stations, and are we thinking about the LRT cars, and even including places where we can put like bigger bikes, like fat bikes, or put cross-country skis. And in some of the LRT cars I saw, they actually had places to put your cross-country skis on the inside the LRT car. I've not seen that done anywhere else in North America. But again, Scandinavians certainly love their cross-country skis. Public art is, again, such an opportunity to do something whimsical and fun. And too often, our public art that we procure is done as though every day is July and not every day is January, which gets back to my principal point, which is that if you can make something successful in January, it's absolutely going to hit it out of the park in July. So if you can really design for January, make that very successful and make that vibrant and make that a great TUD, then we would know it'll do exceedingly well in July, because it requires no effort to get people in Minnesota to go outside in July, but it requires a lot more thoughtfulness to get them to go outside in January. That means the kind of shelters and structures we're using, how we're reusing snow. It was interesting for me in Scandinavian cities or in Quebec City that rather than clear all the snow out of a public space or public square and then simply bring it to a snow dump facility, the city workers take the snow, they pile it up, and then they mash it up, and they encourage kids to make impromptu snow slides and little mazes and labyrinths out of snow. They give them little paint that they can use to sometimes paint on the snow, and they think a lot about how kids use snow. And then they come every couple of days and they mash up the snow again so it's more malleable and not as hard. So rather than get rid of the snow, they actually keep it and turn it into an asset that can be used for kids sometimes. And this is the new convention center in Oslo, and they actually designed the roof, not just as a roof that can be experienced where they have some gardens and a green roof in summertime, but they thought about how the roof of this huge convention center overlooking can be used in wintertime as well, which is very fascinating. And this really comes down to just the principle of what are we doing to, because you have to be so much more deliberate in wintertime. So what are we going to do to create all-season buildings in Minnesota in spaces? What are we going to do to fill in those gaps, whether it's winter markets that can be used where there's dead space to make it more comfortable for pedestrians? What are we doing in terms of lighting and building design? Are we using ice hotels or restaurants or art? Are we encouraging a cafe culture that actually is year-round? Or is Minnesota going to keep doing what it typically does, which is you've got cafes from April to October, but you don't go year-round? It was amazing to me to be in Paris on a day in January when it was minus 17 and people were sitting outside. Minus 17 Celsius is 0 degrees Fahrenheit. And it was shocking to me to be in Paris at 0 degrees Fahrenheit and see people sitting outside. So what they had done was, if you go to the tourist areas of Paris, every cafe will give you a blanket to put on your legs. You keep wearing your winter jacket. They'll pull a plastic sheeting around the patio, and then they'll have gas heaters. So it's the plastic sheeting blocks out the wind. The heating, the gas warms it up a little bit, and then you've got a blanket over your leg. So you'll sit outside and have a meal in that and watch pedestrians go by and have an interaction with those pedestrians and still be able to do people watching. And it was shocking to me that a city like Paris has been doing this for a long time, and yet we in North America don't adequately think about our cafes and sidewalks and how we can still utilize them for all 12 months and not just a few months of the year. We've become really kind of wimpy with this, and we need to change. We need a dress to be outside longer, but we also need to encourage our businesses to actually become more winter city-centric like Paris has, because they didn't want to lose that opportunity to have tables on the street for wintertime. And incorporating fire and seating and making sure that we're putting fire pits in public places. It's interesting to go to Phoenix and Scottsdale, which is obviously a place that many of us think of as very warm, see how often Phoenix and Scottsdale embrace fireplaces and outdoor seating. And because they're a desert, it cools off a lot in winter, or in the summer, or in the nighttime rather. And so they actually have a large number of fire pits in a lot of the public spaces and where people are going to gather. And so we should be doing far more of this in our winter city locations like Minnesota and Canada. All this ultimately is about improving winter life and doing things that are going to get more people outside. And lastly, to close, is also thinking about how do we get for more happy kids? Because I'll tell you what, happy kids equals happy parents. If you make for a fun environment for kids to be outside in wintertime, and we think about how they use public spaces in wintertime, then we're going to make it a lot more inviting for parents, and it's going to have a lot more inclusion then. Thank you very much. That's the presentation.
Thank you. My name is Jim Mayland. I'm with the sports group at Stantec, and I've been designing winter facilities probably for about 32 years of my 37-year career. Do I really look that old? Anyway, I have been doing that, and it's been quite exciting. I'm ahead of a group that does aquatics and ice, so I'm sometimes known as the Iceman, sometimes the aquatic guy, but I am also known as Jim. You can call me Jim. At any rate, we're heavily involved with a lot of strategic projects around the country, placemaking, destinations, things like that. And so I'm going to share a little bit of the strategy of design. Simon did a great job of sort of outlining a lot of the criteria we have to look at. So I might speed through those in the sense of time when we get to some of those. But I also want to mainly show some real interesting projects we've done. As I lose my name. So with that, reimagining ice and water. Again, we do a lot of work with ice, and so we know how to use these facilities. We're often the specialists in these kinds of projects with consultants and landscape architects throughout the country. But the important thing to know is successful outdoor year-round recreational facilities don't just happen. They really have to be thought about very effectively. You saw a lot of the issues that Simon brought up. And I guess what it really comes down to is you're putting these plazas in areas where you're sort of diametrically, you're designing for winter, where we want warmth, we don't want wind, we want warm things to be around, and then in summer we want the complete opposite thing. So orientation, structure, the design of the site gets really challenging to work all four seasons. And so you can't just do what works with one and the other. You have to think about how these different amenities have to be supplied, supported, and how circulation works as well as the comfort level. So an important thing to be thinking about. One of the planning strategies we use for placemaking is the power of 10. Basically 10 places to be, 10 things to do, 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year. And what this really requires, frankly, is a lot of real effort by the person in the community that's running these facilities, because it's heavily programmed so that there are events going on. It just isn't about what you put on the site. It's the programmed events on the site. And so, but it is very successful. We're doing a project right now implementing this in Caldwell, Idaho. I'll tell you about it in a moment. Anyway, successful four-season design. Simon covered a lot of this. Hey, make winter fun, embrace winter. We're from here. Let's not let it go by us. Let's hang on to it. Let's design for comfort. All those things with the sun, the wind, and fire and heat are important. Programming reliable activities in the winter. Certainly reliable is not always reliable. As we know, we look outside and we feel the warmth of yesterday. A lot of winter can go away in a moment, as Simon indicated as well. And so it's important that facilities be designed for reliability to bring people back throughout the winter. And certainly, use of snow. We've in some of our down mountain projects, we've just had, frankly, the Zamboni run out, dump the shavings on a little plaza, and it's amazing what fun can be created by little children by a pile of snow. So those types of things can be very simple, but they can get more complex, like some of the items that Simon was talking about. But essentially, the nightscaping, making sure lighting, making sure it looks fun as well as feels good when you're there is very important. So what we do is we use water for the foundation of most of our four-season designs. We call it summer water in our office. in winter water. Winter water to you probably is what's called ice, and it usually takes a little more finesse than just waiting for things to freeze if you want something to happen properly. Warm weather water can be passive fountains like this, or it can be little interactive channels like shown on the left, which is down in Burnsville at the heart of the city. Or on the right here, a ground fountain spray with lights, music, etc. This is a fountain we did out in Central Park in Maple Grove. And as discussed earlier, ice needs to be reliable. You have to be able to go to some place and expect it. While we, in probably 30, 40 years ago when I was at Tyke, you could go and rely on natural ice, but you can't do that anymore. We put refrigeration in almost everything we do in this environment. I'm afraid even in Edmonton, where Simon's from, they're going to be doing it. I was at the Winter City Conference a few years ago presenting, and in February, and the streets were wet. So this is it's definitely a change, but it's definitely something that has to be invested in to make people come back and have a useful thing. We like to use an ice ribbon for the winter activator. You might ask, what is an ice ribbon? And I'll say, well, hey, it's a transformation. It's a transformation. Oop, it isn't going to happen here on this animation. But it's essentially transforming rectangular shapes of ice, traditional forms of ice, rectangular, into more relaxed forms, ribbons of ice, so to speak, as you see here, that can wander through the park. It gives a lot more flexibility to the design rather than dropping about a 16,000 square foot chunk of concrete in the middle of a park and expecting it to look good in the summer. This gives you some flexibility. And this is sort of, in our mind, is sort of similar to what happened in aquatics about 30 years ago. 30 years ago, the rectangular pool for swimming in suddenly became morphed into these very erratic shapes, water from zero to 16 feet deep, places where you could swim where you didn't have to know how to swim and have a good time. Well, sort of with ice. You make a rectangular sheet of ice, what happens in Minnesota? State of hockey. A hockey game comes up, pucks are flying. It's difficult for people that maybe want to have a good time skating to skate. Well, guess what? You can't play hockey on a skating ribbon. So we've solved that problem. Ice ribbons have been wonderfully successful, both in the winter. This is Maggie Daly Park, 800 people, a typical weekend in Chicago, as well as in the summer. And this doesn't look like a skating ribbon, and it isn't, but it's the center part of the skating ribbon, a place where we've created some space to do something else. And so these are some significant climbing towers in the middle of Maggie Daly Park that they use for some of the summer programming, amongst other things. The cost range for these things can be dramatic. About the least expensive is around $900,000, and they can go up to $3.5 million. And that is really only for the critical ice systems, the piping, the refrigeration plant, the containment systems. It's not for the general site development. It's not for the buildings to put these amenities and put people in. So it's highly dependent on really the site conditions as well. Certainly ice and water aren't always good, especially when they're close to each other. So certainly that has to be looked at carefully. But the length of the season, the area of the ice surface, the quality of the systems we put in, from the very inexpensive commercial prefabricated refrigeration plants to custom-made refrigeration plants the last 40, 50 years, the season of operation and the sophistication of the design all come into play in the cost of these facilities. The first ice ribbon was designed and constructed 10 years ago in Elkhart by Stantec, by my group. There are now 11 ice ribbon projects under our belt from coast to coast. And most recently, for those of you that may have been there in Central Park in Maple Grove, we have an ice ribbon that's part of a larger park, which I'll get into in a short time. There's a lot of problems to solve when you bring ice to any climate, even Minnesota, even in Edmonton, and they mainly have to do with a lot of weather issues. Wind, rain, high ambient, low ambient temperatures, the humidity, direct and indirect solar radiation, these all have a huge impact in the amount of refrigeration and the feasibility of design and the sophistication of the design to make sure we have skatable ice for those 4 months. But also partial shading, blowing dust, snow removal, other big things with weather we have to make sure we have in our design criteria. And another issue, not so important, it's easily solved. Sinking the Zamboni can be easily solved by just not skating on natural ponds. But other things, performance expectations, do you have to have reliable ice? Is this a competitive facility that has Olympic-type events on it? Access, snow removal, rain, how do you cross the ribbon into the middle without causing a chaos and a safety issue? Startup and shutdown procedures, all these things have to be carefully discussed with the owner, because if they don't have a grip on what they're getting and how they have to operate this thing, it will be a lousy facility. And these things are all very important, all on our list of things we go over with clients as we go into a design like this. Typical locations for these kinds of amenities: resorts, town centers, gateways, major community parks, and certainly weather is a big issue on the feasibility. This is a map here of the mean temperature below 32. And you can see my magic red line. We have to look at this yearly because climate is changing. That's true. And the red line in this particular arrangement, above the red line, we feel comfortable with putting a four-season design in without doing too much extra to accommodate itch issues that would crop up with ice feasibility. You get below the red line, we have to look at shade, we have to look at structures that help us enable the ice to be skatable for those seasons, or really shorten up the ice season. Some of you may have been in Texas, or you might have been in San Diego and skated for maybe 2 weeks in the middle of winter when the sun is at its lowest and it's as cool as possible. But that isn't a very long season to invest in something like this. The year-round use becomes challenging, but most difficulties come in the transition, the shoulder seasons. The good thing is the summer, from essentially March, April, I should say from the spring of May through September, is pretty easy and pretty reliable. In the winter, from November to early March or mid-March, about 4 months of time can be typically attained by refrigeration for skating facilities in this climate. But that transition season is a season when you're taking things down, switching over to another mode. It's another area where there's lots of rain, the leaves are falling. It's a little more challenging to have reliable programming there. So something you have to be concerned of, but yet still getting close to 8 months, 9 months of very active use on a park is a pretty dramatic improvement from what we're doing right now. So we typically go through with our clients our potential winter uses, finding compatible uses for a plaza, for a park, for a destination. And this is kind of the master list, so to speak. There's other things we've got in our pocket we may not show you today, but essentially there's lots of different ways to do skating, from the recreational skating to the competition to ice shows, dinner shows, other things like sledding involving snow, sledding and cross-country skiing. Well, what do we do here in Minnesota now when we don't have snow? Well, Three Rivers Park District, City of Minneapolis, has snowmaking, hey, in Minnesota for cross-country skiing and sledding. So it's something that's come here. There's ways to deal with it. It certainly is an expense, and you have to basically make a decision whether it's worth that and find ways to generate revenue to offset some of those things. The other thing with buildings around here, using the buildings for coffee, we have skate rentals operating out of Starbucks Coffee in Milwaukee. Casual dining, fine dining, a community center in one of these locations is a great place for a lot of the events we're showing here ongoing, as well as indoor farmers market, which we're starting to see around here. Summer uses is easy. The list is very long. We've got all the different kinds of fairs, music venues, and festivals that we can have, not to mention ice cream. We've got sporting kind of activities, bocce ball, mini golf, but also outdoor movings, outdoor weddings, interactive play facilities, just relaxing around a nice water feature, interactive water features, as well as skating rental, game tables, music. And this one here, food trucks, a culture that's becoming pretty popular throughout the country. Very popular at a lot of the facilities we do. The climbing, the plaza-style skate parks you saw at the very beginning of this presentation, our sports group developed that sort of dream of a plaza-style skate park with an ice ribbon around it. And one of my favorite, being the aquatics guy and the ice guy, is the lazy river that converts to a skating trail. Instead of getting 4 months out of the outdoor pool of revenue, you generate 8 months by having another season in the winter of reliable skating. Haven't done that yet, but we're looking for anybody interested in that. Successful four-season park. This is how water and ice is so wonderful. This is Canal Park in Washington, D.C. Obviously, winter works well with refrigerated ice. It's sort of a no-brainer. Spring, a little too cold for interactive water, but if the interactive water has light or music, it can be a spectacular thing to look at and attract people into the venue. without having to walk through the water. Summer, obviously, water works well in the heat of the summer, and especially interactive water. In the fall, engaging the area again with some of the interactive water as more of a fountain aesthetic, and food, etc., becomes a great place to be. Bottom line, access and parking is a big deal for any of these big venues. This is Chicago Maggie Daily on a weekend. There's tons of people here. Obviously, Chicago has a lot of transit nearby. And frankly, one of the interesting things about this park, we built this all on about between 4 and 6 feet of geofoam. This is all built on foam on top of a parking structure. We had to reduce the load so the parking structure wouldn't collapse. But a venue where that is very important to this, of parking coming up above and using the facility. So a little, some of the project examples. This is a very TOD-oriented project. In fact, one of the partners was the Transit Authority in New York. This is in Lower Long Island, about maybe 30 minutes, 40 minutes north of Kennedy Airport. And the city was involved in this project. Not-for-profit organization that's run and programming this facility, as well as the TOD was involved. And you can kind of see how this works. You can see sort of the transit running. Let's see if this works. The transit running kind of slicing through here. Transit station here, entering into this Wyandanch Plaza that we developed with Olin Partnership. And so how did this work? Well, these are fresh off the press. This thing just opened in mid-December, and so here's skating, and it looks like it's working pretty well. And from what I can see here, a lot of people going around and having a great time in this plaza. That's, as you can see in the background, it's housing-oriented above, and then certainly condensed commercial development below. And it's in kind of a heart of an area that was sort of deteriorating in Wyandanch. So it's a redevelopment project, and the whole purpose of this was to sort of generate a spur to move things forward in the community and get things going again. So one of the things we always do with ice, fire and ice is a real thing. It works well. So having a little place to warm up, like a fire pit, gas fire pit. Or in the background here, you can kind of see what happens in the summer. All this railing goes away. This becomes a very beautiful plaza in the summer months. And so what you have behind here is sort of a little raised area for performances, as well as all around that area are a lot of jets that make a pretty spectacular fountain in the summer months. So we have water, again, used for the off season, as well as just performances. Pretty common formula for a lot of these types of destination plaza. This is another one we did, Canal Park Ice Ribbon. This is in Washington, D.C. It's on the other side of the Beltway, where people don't go to as much. In fact, the first time I visited the site, I took the taxi, and the guy said, "Why are you going here?" I said, "Well, I'm going here because we're doing a project." He said, "Well, there's nothing here. Everybody leaves at 5 o'clock. I said, "Well, that's why I'm here." So we were working with Olin Partnership on this one as well. It's a 3-block-long park, and it's surrounded by a lot of businesses, as well as it's surrounded by, again, new residential development is growing up in the air, high-density residential with commercial below. And this is one of the blocks that we put on, the ribbon of ice, that uses, certainly, as you can see, ice pretty successfully in the winter months. It's sort of a bone-shaped. It was a very long, narrow site. But as you see, the design and use of the railing is really important in something like this, because of in Washington, D.C., you think we have warm winters. They have really warm winters. And so containing the cold by these railings, these glass railings, is a really important design function we use. And we always make these so they can go away in the summer months. But they are highly important throughout the winter. And certainly other things in this case, there was a pretty neat cube that was put on top of the building right here that doesn't show very well, but it's got a camera that films the people going skating around, and you can look at yourself skating around in this big cube, as well as advertises to the traffic passing by. So it's a pretty good advertisement, as well as a fun thing for people that are there. This is it in the summer months. You can kind of see in the background, the center of the problem with ice and water is ice takes a really dense profile of a lot of pipes to refrigerate and keep things cold. And so there's no room, barely enough room to get concrete through between the pipes, much less things like water features. And so we often use the water feature becomes the area that's not ice. And then the ice ribbon itself becomes sort of the plaza, the area you circulate around. but it works quite well. And here on part of the ice, the center part, that sort of square block we saw, is where the restaurant pulls out and brings their tables and chairs. And so people can go out and sit, have lunch, have dinner, have a drink, watch their children playing in the interactive water, or participate with them as well. And again, food trucks become pretty vital here, particularly at the noon hour. All the businesses nearby, the food trucks line up along the south side of the site and becomes a great place for the people in the businesses to come out, have lunch, sit, watch the water, and a lot of comfortable things to do at that time. Hudson Park Boulevard is another project we did. This is a little bit like my river to skate away idea, but it was designed. We took this all the way to construction documents. It hasn't been built yet, but this is in the ice mode. It's sort of a circular ribbon-like form of ice that becomes a water feature. This is more stagnant water with jets. The one I was talking about earlier is actually making this a lazy river where we circulate this water and people can go around and sit in inner tubes in the summer. Another project we did in Washington Harbor, this is in Georgetown. Some of you might have been here. I put this picture in to show the background. That's the Potomac. This is one of the few pieces of real estate, other than some of the new stuff developing on the north end of Washington, that is on the Potomac. So it's a spectacular place to be. Crew boats going up and down the water. This great plaza here. And this is a high-end residential development up above and down below, bars, restaurants. And so what we were brought out here is the redeveloper of this facility. There was an old water feature here that was sort of dysfunctional, multi-leveled, kind of complicated, not that exciting, and it was dying, and so sort of was the traffic coming to this area. So we went in there and redid the water fountain, working with Crystal Fountains out of Toronto, and created this pretty spectacular light show that has lights as well as music. And it's surrounded by, on 360 degrees, bars and restaurants that look over this. So it's a pretty spectacular sight, as well as the view out onto the Potomac on one side. So that was a pretty easy fix, but then what did we do? They've never had anybody come here in the winter. This becomes a cold, icy place. The Potomac's out there, wind blowing in. Why would you want to be there? Well, maybe if we had some skating, that would work pretty nice. So in this case, it was complicated. We had to bring the ice and bring the system over the top of the fountain. As you saw, there was a lot of trenches, et cetera, with that. And so this isn't ideally how we like to bring ice. We like to have ice usually where you switch the switch, the pipes are in place, you start the transition pretty easily to the ice mode. This one, they have to do some setup, but I pulled this off the website. There's great results. This whole area is seeing people at a time it never saw before in downtown Georgetown, right along the waterfront. So very successful story for this development. And this is a project we're working on right now in Caldwell, Idaho. It's a plaza, and what they've done is Destination Caldwell cleared out, this is the whole block right here. They cleared out this corner of the block and essentially created the back sides of these 100-plus-year-old buildings being the front side to the park. And so a lot of challenges with that. This is the summer mode, kind of how things would happen in summer. And sort of this is the winter mode, where it goes into more of an ice mode, with a central plaza here where a lot of figurines and winter things were going to be set up to make kind of an exciting journey around the ice ribbon as well as the rink. But you can see some of these old buildings, they're 100-plus-year-old buildings, have to suddenly take the load of an ice resurfacer full of water, have to take refrigeration equipment that vibrates. It's getting very expensive, we're finding, to reinforce some of these 100-plus-year-old buildings that have kind of been jury-rigged over the years. And so a lot of cost was involved in that, but yet it preserved the historic kind of aspect of the city. And this is kind of it in a rendering. We're just getting into construction documents right now. You can see the plaza, the amphitheater to the right. In the background is sort of the boulevard area where a lot of we're expecting restaurants and bars to show up. We've got kind of the plaza here, the skate ribbon running along the back alleyway where we have structures with heating elements in them to extend the winter and the fall season for comfortable seating. And there it is in its full glory. In the summer months, we bring water into it. Again, the most important aspect of this is probably the programming of the amphitheater here, which has everything from theater to music to art, etc., going on it all year round. And so again, a nice way to transition from summer to winter. Another project, this is the project we did in Central Park in Maple Grove. You can see kind of the ice ribbon is sort of that eccentric piece of white concrete, and the interactive water feature is over here right next to the building. And so essentially this is in the ribbon. This isn't a particularly busy day. They had a very successful last year. This photo was taken late at night with not too many people on it. We can see the building, the warming house, the skate rental in the background, and the ice ribbon, as well as a pretty neat interactive fountain. This involves a lot of lights, and so this, if they're having a venue or a wedding going on inside the building, they can jump the aesthetics up of the fountain to a higher level. Maggie Daly Ice Ribbon, this is a pretty spectacular piece. This is the grand poopa of all ice ribbons in the country. It's a quarter mile long. It has a skating grade that goes up and downhill. Not like we just saw at Crashed Ice. You don't have to wear helmets and pads. No, this is for the general public. It is a little bit of work going up, but you should see the smiles people going down. They love it. And it's quite talked about. It's right down along the waterfront next to Millennium Park, drawing big crowds. They make $1 million a year just on skate rentals at this facility. So it's been a very successful venue for them. And in the summer months, like I mentioned, we worked with Michael Van Valkenburg on this. He put a pretty spectacular climbing structure in the middle. They're still working on how to do the summer the best possible, but again, it's a venue that's very popular and doing its job in the winter months. This is a Millennium Park right next door. This is on Michigan Avenue, right below the Bean. You can see that in the upper rendering here. It's been a very successful ice project, as well as you can see here in the summer. They bring in the bar, the temporary bar, seating, etc. Again, great place to be with the Bean so close, with Millennium Park so close. And National Gallery of Art, right on It's right along the mall. I think that was the word I was looking for. Thank you. Anyway, this is a transformation of ice, more of a rectangular-shaped ice rink, sunken down inside a pretty spectacular fountain. They bring in some temporary structures for some of the ice, but then in the summertime, it becomes this pretty spectacular water feature in the middle of the sculpture gardens. And certainly, we do a lot of down mountain work. This is in a ski resort. You saw this earlier in Simon's pictures that we did. In the downtown development area, have all these nice little cozy places where there's gas fireplaces. And then in the summer months, they bring in groups for theater, they bring in movies, they bring in skating on the hard surface with rollerblades, etc. So it's a pretty action-packed space in the down mountain area of North Star. And so finally, this is a project we're just starting construction now in Spokane Riverfront Park. Is the site of the World's Fair back in 79. This is very aging. This is the gateway into the park. They're redeveloping a lot of the park now. And the first thing you're going to be seeing now coming into the park is this pretty cool skating ribbon. So that's what I have. And so thank you very much. I'll let John take over and move on. Stay at the front here.
Right, Katrina and Christina are going to be out among you for questions, and we will unmute Simon if the question is for him. So who has a question for either Jim or Simon? Lisa?
Thanks. This question is for Simon. It's Lisa Middag, and I'm the new director of Nicola Activation, which is our downtown mall, which is in the middle of a multi-year reconstruction renovation. And when you think of activation and when you think of us revising our ordinance and our design guidelines, Simon, have you got like maybe a quick list of regulatory hurdles we should watch for that might inhibit four season activation?
Simon doesn't have any quick lists. Just kidding.
There's a lot of things that can be done. Shorthand is I would kind of download the Winter City design guidelines, which are all online on the link I published. You can just Google Edmonton Winter City Design and then download it, and there's a lot of the materials in there. One of the things we're actually changing is the zoning code so that to make it more Winter City centric than what it was previously. We're doing that, and with the idea, of course, is like the Copenhagen example I provided, sometimes the change that we're after isn't going to happen in 2 minutes. It might take a generation to achieve. But the idea of getting this kind of radical change is that it can happen, but it can happen incrementally. But it needs to have relentless progress, so that every year we're doing something to move the ball a little bit down the field. Some years it moves down the field by inches, other years by yards, but that we're having relentless progress to kind of get the radical change that we're at. When you're kind of redeveloping malls and so forth, I mean, the big thing is, like I said, it starts with, are we designing out the wind and are we putting people in the sun? Are we creating, you have to work so much harder to make it successful in January. So the attention to the detail of the ground floor, that first 30 feet, having smaller bays as much as possible is really, really critical. Having more glazing, not less glazing, is really critical as well to get the kind of transparency. I don't know if the public realm's like out adjacent to the space as well, but obviously the type of the public realm, the design of it, how it drains, how the sun hits it, the type of landscaping that you employ in it, the architectural lighting you're using it, the landscape lighting in it, all those things have to be considered and factored in. I'd be happy to talk about it in more detail a little later if you connect with me and talk about it a little bit further. But but the design guidelines are kind of like an easy tool that anybody can use to get some of these ideas. But to get more granular, I'm happy to talk about it offline in more detail if you want.
Other questions? Lucy.
Hi, Lucy's my boss.
I'm sorry, I'm nearsighted.
I'm Catherine Hansen. I work at the TOD office. But my question has to do with the entity that manages the operations and maintenance of these exciting projects. What type of entity, public or private, has been, you know, most successful with keeping up that level of activity and maintenance and operation?
Jim, you want to take that?
Jim probably has a couple comments on this, but my experience is that one of the biggest problems with great design is that even if some people are amenable to spending the capital, nobody ever wants to spend the O&M, and the dollars simply aren't there to do the O&M properly. And one of the challenges we have is that you come up with something, and for example, the parks people will say, well, we can't do that, that costs way too much money. To maintain, and you got to dumb it down in terms of the standard you're building it to. So one of the things we've tried to do is to obviously take a political, and with taking a political, one of the things we try to do is have, if we can get some kind of social license politically, to kind of, within the parks department, almost treat it as two different groups. So almost have one group that's dedicated towards the truly urban public spaces and public realms, so that they have different equipment, different training, and so forth. Because too often, the Parks Department is a universal approach to how they're going to do maintenance, so whether it's a more suburban type of area or a more urban area, they almost want to treat it the same. So they want to have the same garbage receptacles, minimize the maintenance. Basically, all they want to do is basically pick up the trash and cut the grass, and that's it. So it really requires having a separation within the departments and different training and a different focus, so that you're not treating things universally. But to require that, which is what some other cities have done successfully, it's not going to come from the Parks Department. It's going to have to come from the political level pushing it down. That's been my experience. But if you don't do that, then we're going to get dumbed down public spaces that don't really serve the public interest that well.
My experience has been that the types of projects we do are very specialized systems, water features with a lot of control, refrigeration plants with big equipment, Zambonis that we all love to drive, but there's a little challenge sometimes driving those, that oftentimes it works best if they bring in a specialty operational consultant for some of the things, like for ice. But we've also seen some of those people, they bring in people every year, a new group of people, young people, to operate. These organizations are pretty big. They say they're specialized in ICE, but they're only as good as the people that are there. For instance, I was just at
Maggie Daly Park about a month ago, and they've been complaining about during the warmer season where the water's running down and it's doing a lot of damage to the ice. So I go over there and look at it, I go, okay, yeah, but now the ice is 6 inches thick. You're supposed to keep it 2 inches thick. The scuppers we've designed to get the water off the ice are completely blocked. Well, we did that 2 years in a row. I mean, sometimes it doesn't change. So I think the finesse, the answer is you have to, first of all, have a lot of finesse. You have to know what you're getting. And I think bringing in the expertise, the best expertise you can for the types of amenities you have. But certainly even the experts have to be carefully selected because some of them oversell their services and their capabilities. And so I don't know if there's any really clear answer. We have public works, parks people that are some of the most conscientious people. They are running very well some of these amenities, but it comes down to the characters that they have there, the type of culture they built within their parks and recs as far as taking care of things and maintaining and understanding. And so we usually go through a training session. We go through, you know, intro to ice, intro to water kind of stuff with these clients. The problem is a lot of times the wrong people aren't, or the right people aren't there when you're doing that. You're educating the project manager for the project who is on to the next project later. So there's a lot of challenges with that. There's no question about it. I don't think there's any clear answer, but it is definitely something that has to be paid attention to. And we try to do that with a lot of attention to education, as well as bringing contractors back for extended warranties, where they have to go through a startup shutdown period for 2 years rather than one, where everybody forgets that there is the wrong people aren't there the first year, or they don't get it videoed. So again, it's a challenging thing, but I maybe haven't given you a good answer, but the real answer of what we run into in these facilities.
But the real answer is it's a really important question and you really need to think about it. When we did our Heart of the City project, we thought moms would come with toddlers and they would dangle their toes in the water. Well, lo and behold, it became a water park, and with so many kids in the water so much, we had to actually chlorinate the water, which nobody thought about. So I think the main answer is it really is important and needs to be thought about. I'm going to exercise the prerogative of declaring a break at this point, and we'll come back at 25 to 11. And please hold your questions. If you have more questions, we'll have ample time for that at the back. Thanks again to Simon and Jim. Our next presenter is Carol Hale with Metro Transit. We have had the opportunity to think about winter cities broadly at the large scale and talk about big projects. I think it probably is worth saying that those of us who are familiar with our transit corridors in the Twin Cities and the stations that we have recognize that you're not going to put one of these facilities at every transit station. But if you do think about the whole notion of the last mile, and the opportunities of making connections to these stations, it opens up the areas that we can think about in terms of thinking about these places. So Carol's going to bring it down to a much more granular level for us here in Minnesota. So Carol, if you would, please.
Thank you very much, John. Thanks, everybody, for coming. Like John mentioned, I'll talk a little bit about transit service and facility considerations during the wintertime. I'm wanting also, though, to make sure that I am talking about things that, you know, pertain to everyone. So there's a group of people, I'm sure, here that live or work in not downtown Minneapolis and downtown St. Paul. Is that correct? Great. So basically I'll give you an overview of, like I said, transit service and facility considerations, and how public and private folks can work together really to have the best results for our communities, the people that live in them, the people that work in them, and just folks that visit. So in general, who enjoys commuting in the wintertime, especially if this is what you are facing? Generally, you know, if you're choosing to drive to work or to school or wherever, you know, to run your errands, you're facing a lot more challenges than you would in the summertime, which is not a surprise. But you know, spending increased amount of time getting ready to go, so warming up your car, scraping off the ice that forms over your windshield, facing slick road conditions. You know, if there's a snow event, you know that it's going to take you forever to get home. So that can have not only negative impacts for the environment, so leading to more air pollution, idling cars, things like that, but also just to your mental health. You know, again, the added stress, you know, less time spent outside, less vitamin D, everything like that. Not to say that folks that are using transit don't face some of the same considerations, but I think it's compounded a bit when you're you know, facing a freeway that's snowy and crashes everywhere and, you know, triple your commute time. So transit ridership does change during the winter time, which is not a surprise. Really though, looking at which type of transit is important when you're thinking about, you know, considerations for service and facilities. So for instance, fixed route transit really sees an increase when we're getting snowy weather. It's very reliable. You know your train, your North Star or LRT or, you know, fixed route service, you know that that's going to be on time. It's coming in 10 minutes. You're going to get where you need to go. We do see, Metro Transit does see decreases in ridership on local bus service, though, during snow events, because not surprisingly, buses are beholden to a lot of the same factors that, you know, automobiles are. If the roads aren't clear, it takes our buses longer to get where they need to go. If it's taking folks longer to get on and off the bus, again, that really reduces our reliability. You'll see the two asterisks there. We do have a new service, arterial bus rapid transit. It's a little too early for us to accurately say, you know, what that is looking like for us operationally and functionally in the wintertime. However, you know, some of the things that make arterial BRT unique or more of a train-like experience, so you know that once you get to that platform, there's a heated waiting area for you. You know that there's signal priority on the bus so that it's, you know, more able to be more reliable getting there, things like that. When we're seeing frigid temperatures, though, and for that, really anything below, you know, 10, 20 degrees, all modes see a little bit of a reduction. That's just because it's really cold. So that also really one of the important factors when we're thinking about winter and transit is the stops and stations that we're looking at. So there's a very wide variety across, you know, a 7-county metro. Again, if you're arriving to an LRT station platform, those are maintained very frequently. They have much, you know, very high ridership. They're also located more, you know, centrally so that it's easier for us to get to in a timely manner to maintain them. As there are bus shelters placed, Metro Transit's committed to removing the snow in and around the bus shelter. So people, you know, once you get to that sheltered space, you're able to wait, you know, again, out of a snowbank. There's a lot of instances, though, where you will see, you know, the windrow that will happen. Cities do a great job of, you know, plowing the roads and the sidewalks in a quick, timely manner as they can. But a lot of times what you're facing or what, you know, a unique opportunity to solve will be, again, these windrows that make it a little more difficult to get on and off a bus. And park and rides are a little, you know, again, another little unique piece. A great thing is they're keeping, you know, again, more and more cars off of the freeway so that plows can do their jobs, you know, less crashes, less congestion, things like that. It's also, though, I mean, you know, if you're getting to a park and ride and taking your bus to where you need to go, again, you don't have to worry about whether the road is icy, things like that. It's the bus is going to get you where you need to go. They can also provide a sense of community. One of my colleagues has a really great story of she arrives to her park and ride every day, commutes into our office over here, and the group of people, they've gotten to know one another. They don't live next to each other by any means, but they've all become friends. They have their little, you know, bus buddy group that sits in the back, and it's great. Transit creates opportunities, though, really kind of everywhere. Transit stops and stations really are activity hubs that do provide opportunity for either, you know, shared use facilities. If you want to do community outreach, you know these spaces will be active because, again, people need to move around for their daily life. And it's also, you know, choosing to think of your walk to and from transit, you know, as a stealthy form of exercise, not only getting your steps in, but again, you're getting more fresh air, more exercise, and it's exciting to run after a bus or a train, and then when you catch it, oh, there's, you know, no, hardly more of an exhilarating feeling to me when you catch it. Conversely, there's hardly a more devastating feeling when you just miss it, so yeah. So actually, I'll back up. So transit does create opportunities. There's also some challenges. Again, you know, waiting facilities do take up valuable real estate in the public right-of-way. As we're looking at some considerations or concerns about snow removal, access to and from transit, you know, really clear space and space for people to queue, people to walk through who maybe aren't getting on or off a bus or a train at that stop. You know, that's very important. And so that opens up an opportunity not only for integrated waiting facilities, so within the footprint of a building or other structure, it also provides opportunities for partnerships. So that's kind of what I'll get into, and we'll go through a few different levels of that. So first off, these are a few examples of some really pared down integrated waiting facilities that are not much more than, you know, a nook within a building footprint, an awning. So if you're waiting in there, you are definitely protected from rain coming straight down. And there's some level of wind protection. But really, it's not what I would call an incredibly pleasant place to wait or to be. This example, though, is on Lake Street and Hennepin and Uptown. If you look at the picture on, I guess, your left, it really appears at first glance not much more than a nook, again, within a building footprint, with a little circle T that, so you know that, you know, some form of transit will stop there at some point. But if you look a little more closely, you'll notice, again, they have a unique bus stop sign within the waiting area. They also have heaters and light, so it's much more comfortable to wait in that space. And if you look up in the corner by the brick there, they have those little reflective domes so that if you're waiting in there and you're not sure exactly when your bus is coming, you don't have to, you know, poke your head out and experience the rain or snow that's happening that you're waiting away from. You just look up on that little round dome and you see it coming. It's a high enough ridership stop where the buses stop there regardless. And it works out really well. One other really great thing is that, you know, when there's a integrated facility like this, it removes some of the maintenance burden, I guess I would say, for Metro Transit. So this facility gets cleaned daily or on an as-needed basis because there's a, you know, a dedicated person that's doing maintenance for that, you know, that site. So if something happens, it's cleaned up immediately rather than waiting, you know, however many hours till Metro Transit finds out about it and is able to deploy folks. So I think it's really great. Another example would be, this is on the corner of Penn and Broadway. So originally this facility had been designed to, again, be somewhat of a, you know, notch in a bricked out area. We were able to work with them, though, to include a lot of elements. So the taller image to the right there, while it may look like an unexciting sidewalk to you, to me it's very exciting because the stop will eventually become a bus rapid transit stop. And so we've been able to plan ahead for the future for that. The area that's the darker colored concrete, that's the length of the platform that we were able to have installed now so that there'd be less disruption for customers later, but also for anybody who is, you know, living in the building, who is just walking down the sidewalk. It'll also demarcate the area that Metro Transit will remove the snow from in a very timely manner so that, again, boarding will be very easy and service, again, reliability will be what it wants to be. What's not pictured there are the addition of benches. You know, when there's an integrated facility like this, building owners or designers are able to pick whichever sort of seating they want, so long as it's accessible, you know, for folks. We don't really mind, you know, what you're picking because, again, the day-to-day cleaning and maintenance is oftentimes picked up by the property owner, so that's really helpful for us. So quickly, I think I'm running out of time a little bit, but I want to talk a little bit about the idea of, instead of P3s, everybody knows the public-private partnership, but when we're thinking about that, that's what's creating the opportunity, or a really great opportunity for placemaking. So I had a really great opportunity to work with Ben and Max on this top image. This was living room station. It's definitely not really shown in the winter, but thinking about context-sensitive solutions, so what people want in a specific space, or you know, who is using this space, what is adjacent to it, what makes the most sense to put there. Actually asking people who are using that space, you know, what do you want, what can we provide, what makes it easier. So for you know, building owners, if there's opportunity again to you know, create space, but if there's other partnership opportunities, either with you know the businesses that are within that building footprint, if there's you know opportunities to partner with the city, if there's opportunities to partner with you know other complementary agencies, that's how you end up with a really great result. And the bottom image is actually my very favorite bus waiting facility. I never thought I would have one, but I do. It's in Paris, France, and really, you know, what better way to look at, you know, what you can provide. They have a frit pattern that you can see on the bus shelter in the back, the design that's on the glass. Not only is that functioning to prevent graffiti and that, but they're also using it, you know, to display the street grid. So it's working for wayfinding. It's doing more than just one thing. There's also the activation. So if you want to, you know, check out a bike, or they have a little free lending library or a little coffee cart, every possible thing that, you know, folks could want, they have, and it works, not just because of, you know, some one person at a transit agency wants it, or one person working at a city or a private entity wants it. You know, you work together and you can come up with something phenomenal, and really, you know, pool your resources and, you know, look at the strengths that each different group can provide and bring to the table to come up with a really great result. So I apologize for this one. This was supposed to be a video. I don't know who all, if you haven't seen it, just Google bus stop dance party. So recently, in a really cold snap a month or two ago, it was so cold that the lights that we had in our transit shelter were flickering and pulsing. So someone chose to do a, you know, an impromptu EDM dance party and post it on YouTube. So really, attitude, again, when you're thinking about your commute or how you can work with folks to think about their commute differently, no, waiting for transit when it's really windy and cold isn't always pleasant. However, you are getting fresh air, you are getting exercise. If your light's flickering, you can absolutely dance to it and post that on YouTube. And I had to end with the Twinkle Bus just because it's so great. It makes everybody happy. And that was my first introduction, actually, to Metro Transit when I moved to Minneapolis, and just thought, you know, what a great way to celebrate, again, winter, darkness. Clearly, it's a, you know, agency that really embraces the seasonality of the region we live in, so... With that, I'll turn it over.
Questions. We've heard a lot of great ideas, and we'll be focusing the next 15 minutes on making it happen and doing the work, especially in the meantime, between now and when some giant capital projects can occur. All right. I didn't realize I did the fade outs in that way, but it'll be a snowflake fade. So we're the Music Can't Group. Our motto is we create places where people feel alive. We do that through an integrated service that acknowledges the need of every great place to have a good design, have good management and stewardship, and have useful and enjoyable events and activities happening there. And then figuring out what that right ecosystem is through a combination of user engagement, communications, and data collection and evaluation. And when everything's working well, you have a great place, no matter what the season, that is useful, meaningful, and continuously adaptable to what's going on. And so over the last 5 years, we've applied this methodology to spaces of a whole different range, which we'll investigate a few of them, from scales from huge office buildings down to front yards. And so our strategy of place before we dive into winter placemaking on a tactical level is that if people are having positive and useful experiences in a place, then they're obviously going to want to use it more. And then the more that you use it, people start then establishing habits and routines. And these habits and routines are the foundation upon which relationships are formed and be able to be based. If you're going to an area again and again and again, you're able not to just recognize somebody, but also finally get to know them, have conversations. It's also the thing that supports enterprise. If people are going back into a space on a daily or even a seasonal basis, that is something that businesses can rely upon, and that is what supports that commercial enterprise. So it's both community and commercial uses both benefit from establishing these everyday or regular habits and routines and forming that relationship. And those relationships are with people, but also with people to a physical place as well. And I think we can all think of physical spaces that we feel like we are really connected to and have relationships with. And that is really the essence of value, both on the, again, on the community and social side, but then also on the commercial side. If we think of the real estate adage of location, 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 what does that really mean? It's that people want to be there, they feel connected to it, there's useful experiences there. And so that is really the essence of why placemaking is not only important for our social fabric, but also for establishing strong economies as well. Snowflake fate. So in creating winter places, a lot of this has already been covered, so I won't belabor it too far, but our constraints physically are that it's cold and it's dark. The constraints, those are can be easily overcome, which we'll look into. The harder ones are cultural constraints of viewing cold as a bad thing, poorly maintained pedestrian ways for people. A willingness, I think, especially in Minnesota, to do fun things in the woods, but just totally give up on the urban experience. And then I think we do really good special events here, but focusing on that everyday experience is not quite as strong. And then some of the opportunities, because constraints create, allow for creativity, is to contrast that cold and that dark with warmth and light. And then really reframing what it means for there to be colder temperatures, and that's not associating that with bad things, reprioritizing that human experience, celebrating all that we can do in the winter in the city, and then really focusing on that everyday aspect, on those habits and routines. And then before I jump into some of our case studies about how we've done this in action, there's a couple other things that in hearing the presentations I also wanted to highlight in getting out of the meaning of these pilots. Which is one, that every space can and should be a social space. It's not just for parks and plazas and areas of congregation. It can be and should be bus stops, as we'll see, strip malls, really sort of what we now view as inhospitable spaces can and should be social spaces. Two, following a process over a product. We've seen a lot of really amazing, inspiring spaces already today, but we should really look at the process that led to these spaces being successful rather than copying just the end product in of themselves. And then on a related note, it's really about the relationship between the elements that makes a great place rather than just focusing on the elements themselves. It's how the ice rink relates to the warming house, which relates to the buildings, which relate to the people and the events that happen there, that really creates that experience in that place rather than just the pure fact that those elements are there. I think we've all been in places that have a lot of right ingredients, but they maybe weren't applied and cooked in the right way to make them all really create those adjacent values and synergies. Yeah, and with that, we'll snowflake fade into our first thing. Oh, here, well, one more set of guidance. Things that we've also learned through doing these winter experiences is that people want to be warm, and people get cold when they're bored. You know, being warm is sort of a state of mind, and so if people are really engaged and they're having a fun time, no matter what the temperature is, they're going to stay warm. The moment they get bored, they're going to get really cold and they're going to leave. They need to be nourished and you have food. People want to still be physically active outside. People enjoy intergenerational connections, so that 8 to 80 thing, socializing, they like making things, being creative, and that people oftentimes buy things to memorialize an experience as much as they are buying things because they actually need it. So by having merchandising next to fun experiences, you create, people want to associate that emotion with a physical thing that they can take with them. So the first project that we worked on, which was in collaboration with Yasna Hadzic, who's now at the state DOT, was a few years ago with Colleen Carey and her Cornerstone Group in Richfield. It was a vacant, like 10-acre site on Lindale and 60th, which is now being redeveloped over a series of years into Lindale Gardens. And they really wanted to kickstart that redevelopment by doing a winter market in a parking lot, in a vacant parking lot, with no on-site electricity, power, utilities, or amenities of any kind. And so with that, we wanted to make sure that we created as many interactive types of things for people to do. And so we created dynamic edges, which are important because we experience things along an edge, and then lots of centers of activity within those edges. So an edge of about 25 vendors, and then at the end of that line was fire, with you can make s'mores, with food trucks, there were sing-alongs, s'more making, fire performers, elves that gave advice for a nickel. And I think what one thing was really, there was one story that really stood out for me here, which I had some friends that came, and they told me that, they came, they immediately visited the vendors, they didn't buy anything, but there was a fire to keep them warm, and there's some food to eat, so they hung around for a little bit. And then they went back to the vendor stalls again, they still didn't buy anything, but they just did a lap. But then there was still more stuff to do, and there was like a new round of entertainment, they maybe bought some food from the food truck. They sat around the fire, listened to some music, and then one of them was like, you know, we saw that pottery vendor like twice as we passed by, and it was like, I kind of really liked one of those things. And it was a third time they went back and actually bought something. So the longer that somebody's in a space, the more likely, the higher likelihood they are to build a relationship and to buy stuff. So really focusing on that entire experience and not just the sort of like the gee whiz wow moment, but then what is left to sort of hold somebody in that space and keep them there longer. The second one we'll talk about is a really inhospitable space. This is this was a half-occupied ex-urban strip mall in Albertville that was recently purchased by the Hempel Companies a few years ago when they brought us on. And they wanted to also like sort of reposition this shopping center and reintroduce the community to the space, which everyone knows about mostly as the outlet mall capital of the northern suburbs. But this was really the neighborhood shopping center. And so they wanted to activate that and make it into a better place that people wanted to be. And so this is a challenging site and a challenging location. But we really, through the process of engaging with the community and really focusing on those core elements of keeping people warm, keeping people, it was a very cold day when we did this. It was probably like 5 degrees out. Having interactive activities, involving different community groups, and having like a real range of things for people to do. As you can see, the common theme of the fire, music making, fire performers, involving the fire department in the fire is a great way to get through regulatory hurdles around doing outdoor fires. Pro tip. As you can see, it's like how everything relates to each other was so critical. And so it was a really tight event physically with the everything rooted around that common center of those fires, with the food and the activities and the storefront and the businesses really adjacent to those things to make sure that the benefits were really spreading out to all involved. And this is a great reminder, this project and the number of others that we'll talk about were really only made possible by my colleague, Catherine O'Neill, who's in the back right next to Yasna, who's right next to Laura, who's also a champion of another project we'll talk about in a second. Which is this one, lo and behold. So this is a project we're now working on in downtown St. Paul, along with that's funded through the Knight Foundation in very close collaboration with the City of St. Paul and Metro Transit. This is a future development site on 5th and Minnesota. It's also the busiest transit stop in downtown St. Paul, with the busiest light rail stop in the downtown network, as well as a very busy bus stop. And so for the last couple of years, this has been what that site has looked like since the light rail went in. And so while it's very busy for transit, there's not really no other reason to be in that space. And so while the development process is underway, and we're waiting for that to happen, as all the different pieces, complicated pieces, are coming together, we're doing a year-long, hopefully maybe more, activation of this space to make it into a place that is really pleasant and an enjoyable place for the transit riders, office workers, visitors of St. Paul, residents, and really filling that vacuum. But what do you do in a space like this? It's so big and has a wide array of users that people did not believe could all enjoy the space at the same time. And so we've done two pop-up events thus far. One actually just happened yesterday in the Skyway. It was a Valentine's Day event, which was very successful. But this one was on a winter solstice. And so again, you'll see some common themes here with food, and there's s'mores and fire and coob, lawn games, and things like that. But what's really most important about here is like this photo here, which you'll see the police department playing coob and lawn games with a lot of the youth that were and transit riders that are in that space that have had not the greatest relationship with each other. And so, again, it was the process. You know, certainly you're seeing these common elements, but the process of organizing this event to bring all these parties together and really demonstrating that everybody can enjoy, and obviously does enjoy, fire and s'mores and playing games and live music, and that we can all share a space together. And even a space that's as massive and as sort of empty as Central Station is at this moment, can be activated in the wintertime with relatively few resources, as long as people are coming together and you've got the sort of the go-ahead to make things happen. Transitioning that is into a larger project, which is looking at our indoor spaces. We have a lot of indoor spaces in the Twin Cities, our atriums, skyways, et cetera. And we can and should be looking at these spaces as places that are public spaces that we can congregate and that we sort of treat as public spaces, parks, plazas, et cetera. And so this is at the base of the largest office building in the state. And it's a third workplace, it's co-working, it's hotel lounge, it's a public venue for anybody to come in. You've got that central hearth, a Peace Coffee Bar. And then my colleague John, who's going to talk about the 612 Sauna Society, but he's in charge of putting on over 250 events here a year, which range from Valentine's Day card making we've done the last 2 days, summer farmers markets, mindfulness classes, handwork sessions, a whole host of things in the winter and the summertime to really utilize these common area spaces. And then on another larger scale, looking at new build projects and how they're thinking about the winter. This is a rendering of the Nordic House, which will be going in next to the Free House restaurant. It'll be a 9-ish story office building on Washington Avenue. Really exciting, with about a half acre plaza right next to it. And United Properties and Cushman Wakefield, who's a leasing agent, if you're interested, Jim Montez is back there, he'd be happy to talk to you about it. I really wanted this to be a fun place in the summertime, but also the wintertime for the office tenants, but also the community and the nearby residences that are being built as well. So this is a summertime rendering, but for the winter, it'll have like a fire pit that'll be outside running year round, and most exciting will be the first sort of outdoor curling court in Minneapolis, and probably in the region as far as we know. And so that'll be a new sort of destination space, sort of like the outdoor version of Brits lawn bowling, that'll be accessible and fun for everybody and adjacent to all those other residences. And so with that, I'll finish up this last part before we segue over and talking about the Piazza on the Mall, which is a place where we tried a lot of things out. And another lesson of a lot of these things we've just shown is that you can do small pilot projects that lead to large-scale changes. With the Piazza, which was a space we ran for 3 years on Nicollet Mall for Westminster Presbyterian Church prior to their redevelopment of this space, which is currently happening now, and which will rebuild a plaza in this space, they really wanted us to push the boundary on what it would mean to be a real community space to invite people in throughout the year. And so using a lot of fun tactics and again, not a lot of money, but intention and elbow grease, we were able to do a lot of innovative stuff. So this was a snow maze that we built in 2013. I would get out there with a snow blower every time it would snow and just do it. And again, if you're talking about snow removal, there's a way to do it, you know, mindlessly, or there's a way to do it creatively and intentionally. And so this, through not a lot of extra work, you can just, ta-da, you've got a snow maze. And so it'd be a fun place to bring kids and run around in there, et cetera. We partnered with a nearby yoga studio to create Snoga, which is snow yoga, which benefited the American Heart Association every year. It was a 3-year initiative. We worked with a church to start creating new habits, routines, and traditions for them, which they started having winter caroling outside. They'd been very internal in everything they did, and this really allowed them to come out to the community and really engage in the city around them. You can see me roasting chestnuts as part of the event for the people there. Another one we did was the Hot House event, where we built the first trial for our outdoor curling club, or outdoor curling court, and we brought down an Olympic medal-winning curler from Duluth to give lessons. It was through this pilot project experiment that gave us the idea and the knowledge to really inform that Nordic House more permanent fixture, so great lesson there. Indoor movies and tents, outdoor music, fire performers again. And then the very last thing we did in that space was what we knew about the success of fire and how much people loved it, and found the 612 Sauna Society, and met John and his colleagues, and was the very first sponsor of the Little Box Sauna and the 612 Sauna Society in their residency in December of 2015. And then John will now talk about the process and the journey of the 612 Sauna Society and where it is today after this first kickoff.
Thanks, Max. Yeah, when before Little Box and our first residency, our first public residency here, I was hosting sauna for 2 years in my backyard, or in other people's backyards, rather. I built a mobile sauna called the Firehouse, and just started inviting friends over. Friends started bringing friends. Pretty soon I was hosting sauna almost every night of the week, hosted over, I think, 2,000 people by the end of this season. Max mentioned now I'm at Capella, and the coffee shop that he pointed out there is also my office, so people are often walking by, and I have hosted many thousands of people in sauna, and it's not uncommon for people to walk by and say, "Hey, JP, I didn't recognize you. You're wearing clothes." And of course, it's a public space, and often my colleagues and bosses are there. No, it's not really what it sounds like. Context is everything. But we do have a very special context for sauna and for the project that I've been leading for the last 2 years. In the context of sauna, more broadly, sweat bathing, many cultures, the Finns have sauna, the Russians have banya, Japanese have onsen, the Turks have the hammam, in Mexico, the Temescal, of course, the Native American sweat lodge. So the ritual, the practice of getting together and enjoying warmth in the winter is not exclusive to this area, but very special here. Our Finnish heritage, the Finns that settled around the North Shore, brought sauna to North America. This is one of the first places where people really started to enjoy the tradition in North America. So it's very special tradition for a lot of us who've, grew up with it at cabins or at the summer camps, and yet in the city where it's really in my opinion, needed most, where we're really, you know, disconnected and spend a lot of time on screens. It's hard to find a really good sauna. So Max came to one of my gatherings and helped me get the project out of my backyard and into public spaces. And really, to my surprise, it really just continued to be the really special. It really continued to resonate with just the kind of the specialness that kept me doing it night after night in my own backyard just for fun. And it's continued to grow. The 612 Sauna Society started as just a Facebook group. I got sick of answering text messages before saunas, and I just created a Facebook page and say, this many spots, you guys figure it out. And now it's the most active online sauna community in the world. And we wanted to keep going with the project. We couldn't get access to a little box this year, so we decided to build our own, which we did with a Kickstarter in October. We raised $32,000 and built an excellent wood-fired mobile sauna in 2 months with over 50 volunteers. And we just launched the project over at Surly Brewery, where we're now fulfilling we sold reservations through the Kickstarter, and now we're fulfilling those reservations at Surly. Every night's been full. We have a team of 4 volunteers every night who's hosting, so I'm not the only one now hosting the sauna. And we're gonna be rolling all of this into a co-op that we'll be launching next month through a program at the American Swedish Institute, where we'll be talking about, there's a fashion exhibit on the Nordic identity, and we're also gonna be talking about the cooperative mentality as central to the Nordic identity. So we're very happy to be a part of that. 1 minute, we did it. So just a few pictures here of it's the experience of sauna, is one of coming together. One of the really special aspects of this project has been from the very beginning that it's provided people a chance to get together, not just for sauna, but in just making the project happen. So we're creating a co-op just because it's kind of what already is there. People have come together to make it possible, so now people will be able to come together to keep it going, those who want to. It'll work similarly to the co-op in the Northeast. If you don't have room to build a climbing wall in your backyard, you become a member to make that resource available. Same thing with sauna. A lot of people don't have access to a very good wood-fired sauna, so they now will be able to. So people are coming together and enjoying heat in the wintertime. And one thing I wanted to bring into this conversation is the unique opportunity of the physiology of winter, of doing things like getting active in winter, how it activates your thermoregulatory system. And our motto at the Music Camp Group is making places where people feel alive, and there's a real physiology to that when you give your body a chance to bring its temperature into its equilibrium. You're activating your blood flow, you're activating just a whole set of neurological processes that really do make you feel alive. There's a reason that sauna has been around for over 1,000 years, and it's because it feels good and it enables us to really feel more alive in wintertime. And a lot of the projects, you know, coming together and doing fun things in winter, we really need this, like on a physiological level. Once you experience access to sauna and just how good it feels to feel fully awake, fully active, not cold in the wintertime, it's really hard to live without it. That's our goal. That's our goal, and we're doing it by just providing the experience for people, and those that want to be a part of it can keep coming back. And I'm going to pass it back off to Max here.
All right. And then just in close, here's some tips and tricks we have. The first four are we said at length. Per dollar spent, we'd also say focus on social and, you know, on programming. Make sure you budget for that in your capital projects on how to operate these designs and facilities that are being built. Again, treat those indoor spaces like they're public spaces. Leverage existing centers of winter activity. If you've got a great active ice rink, start putting more stuff around there and make it a fun place for people to stick around and really enjoy. And then also on your regulatory and licensing side, looked at and examined to make sure that small good things can happen easily, and that people can do these sort of small pop-up stuff without a lot of hurdles. So with that, thank you very much.
So at least three of the speakers have talked about constraints and obstacles and the problems that winter can create for pedestrians and bicycles. And Kurt Wayne is going to talk to us about City of Minneapolis's current study and how the city is planning to tackle that issue and some of the things that they're thinking about. Kurt?
Thank you. Okay, there we go. All right. My name is Kurt Wayne. As I've been introduced already, I'm with the City of Minneapolis Public Works. I wanted to give a brief presentation to you guys in some detail today about the Minneapolis Pedestrian and Bicycle Winter Maintenance Study. And I've got kind of a subtitle here for you. We're really looking at this and how do we make all the pieces work? How do we coordinate this all together? How do we consider or sometimes reconsider our multimodal networks in wintertime? So I wanted to just give you a little bit of an overview because this is a study that's both exciting to work on because we're able to do more than we already are with our bicycle and pedestrian networks in the wintertime. And it's a study that's got some energy around the city too in terms of people are interested in this. So it's kind of an exciting time to work on this topic. Okay, so stop me if you've heard this one before. Maybe you're at a public meeting or you're just having a conversation. You're talking about walking or bicycling and these modes of transportation and how people get around the city and how it works in neighborhoods. And the subject of wintertime or year-round usage comes up. And maybe there's one person, maybe there isn't, but there's a person that chimes in and says, you know, we do live in Minnesota, right? And there's kind of a dramatic pause too. And then you know that there's wintertime 3 months out of the year, 4 months out of the year. And you typically know, too, if they say the wintertime lasts 6 or more months, they're really kind of against this in the first place. Just like, why are we talking about this? You know, what's the big idea here? Well, the big idea has to do with, again, sort of the theme of this conference. We want to reimagine how we view our city in the wintertime. And so in this case, we want to reimagine or really get back to basics in terms of how we get around in our neighborhoods. And for the longest time, it's been walking to get from A to B, or to get part of the trip from A to B is walking, and bicycling too. And so we know that we can't reimagine wintertime as a season. That's not gonna change. We have no control over that. And we can't completely reimagine, you know, all the practices and nuts and bolts, and let's completely revamp how winter maintenance works, you know, in the city of Minneapolis. We can't really do that either. But we can take another step in reimagining how all of the transportation systems and how people, not just vehicles, but people, get from A to B and how we do that year round. And so that's really the impetus of this study. Another thing we have to consider when we're considering our sidewalks and our bike lanes and our bike facilities is that to maintain them, and particularly to maintain them in the wintertime, it takes a lot of everyday coordination, a lot of different departments and entities that factor into this. So obviously, one of the big ones for us with the city is our maintenance and repair department. They are the ones that do a lot of the heavy lifting when it comes to clearing our streets, clearing our bike lanes, clearing our protected bikeways, and I'll get into that a little bit more later. We've got regulatory services here, too. It's listed because they also have a role in identifying where the abandoned properties are. So where we have gaps in sidewalk clearance, we can get to those gaps. Our 311 system in the city is kind of the main voice of the people, I suppose, or complaint system in terms of getting a ticket or an item into you know, so-and-so, or I've noticed that their sidewalk is not clear here, or there's a problem with this bus stop or this intersection or this bike lane needs some additional clearance. 311 is the point for that. Our communications department has a role to play and an even bigger role, which I'll talk about in a minute, with getting the message out. And not just in terms of, you know, there's a snow emergency tonight, better move your cars. Also getting the message out about what some of the expectations are for homeowners in the wintertime and what some of the things that we can do as a city and as residents in the wintertime with our transportation, what are the opportunities there too. I mention as well special service districts here. They don't play an active role necessarily in clearing sidewalks, but there are at least a dozen special service districts within the city that essentially create a different way that sidewalks can be cleared, not by individual property owners, but as a collective group. We have many external partners that factor in and help us with some of the maintenance and considerations in the wintertime. I know some of the big ones I can think of, but not all of them, are Minnesota Department of Transportation and Hennepin County, as well as Metro Transit. I've got this picture up here because it's a fun little scenario of, as you just look at it and suddenly you start to realize, okay, well, you've got a Metro Transit bus stop there, and it's at the intersection of a city road and a county road, and yes, it does exist in some sort of special service district. So how does all the maintenance work here? It gets a little complicated, it gets a little confusing, and then you add on top of that all the private property owners, and it's a complex system. And it's a system that is working well right now, but through this study, we're going to see how it can work even better. So, briefly here, the goals of the winter maintenance study that the city of Minneapolis is conducting is we're going to take a look at other cities' winter maintenance activities to see some comparisons, to see some ways to do and think about things differently when it comes to clearing sidewalks and clearing bike lanes. And I've got a couple examples of those in this presentation near the end. We want to also understand our current city of Minneapolis practices when it comes to winter maintenance. We know a lot of them already, but we also want to assess how they really interact with each other and how we work within our own departments on the whole goal, really, of getting winter maintenance done in a timely manner for these modes so that, you know, people that are walking, people that are biking can use that as transportation. And then we want to also consider or really determine the priorities, costs, and feasibility of winter maintenance. We want to take what we've learned through the study, not just through this study, but through other things that we've learned in the past too, and come up with some scenarios that can really tell us, give us a path for the future to make these transportation systems work better for people. I've got listed here too something that kind of oversees a lot of the things that we think about and kind of is overarching on this study too is, as part of our complete streets policy, we have a modal priority framework. And really, we want to consider it as, you know, as it says in the modal priority framework, you know, pedestrians are sort of, or they are the top priority of how we view the transportation system, and then bikes and transit below that, and then automobiles. So we keep this in mind when we think about this study and we think about winter maintenance and our practices too. So to know a little bit more about winter maintenance here in Minneapolis, you have to kind of understand our system too. As you can see a little bit or pretty well in this map here, we do have the traditional street grid style of system. We've got 235 miles of bikeways within the city, and it breaks down into protected bikeways, which do include off-street trails as well as on-street protected bikeways, bike lanes, bike boulevards, as well as some shared lane facilities, which can include some wide outside lanes. It includes a few different types of facilities. We have more than 1,700 miles of sidewalk, so this does become a challenge. More than 800 signalized intersections and 3,700 city-maintained crosswalks. So it's a big system to put together for everyone, but that is exactly the task that we're trying to do in the study, and we're continuing to try to do every time winter comes around. So I wanted to give a few examples about what we're learning in the study right now that's working well, at least already. And so this first example here is actually of one of our on-street protected bikeways. In this example, we've got actually city crews are out there right there, right now, working on clearing the bikeway. I use this example because our maintenance department is viewing protected bikeways that are on street as essentially part of the street maintenance when it comes to snow mitigation, snow removal on that street. So what will happen here is that when the snow plows will come along first and sort of create some sort of windrows in that barrier area, what they also have is specialized equipment that comes around next to then clear out the protected bikeways specifically. And then if there is a lot of snow or too much snow in the buffered area or around the bollards, they have equipment then there too that can help clear the snow out of that area. So a higher priority is given to these protected bikeways, and it really shows in some of the clearance rates and how the protected bikeways can be used in the wintertime. I also wanted to indicate that The city also used a lot of the same equipment to help clear out a lot of the windrows, a lot of the snow plow lines that you can see there at intersections within the city. I wanted to highlight another thing that works here, and this is the sort of snow clearance policy when it comes into complaints with 311. You can see how the system sort of works in terms of the graphic up here. But another thing I wanted to highlight is that within the past few months, actually, the city has streamlined this system so that it works even faster. You know, we have, it's 24 hours for single family and duplexes to, you know, the responsibility of moving the snow from the sidewalks, and it's less than that for businesses. But we have control over how fast our process works too, and we've been able to streamline that so we can get compliance on our city sidewalks even faster. One other thing that is working well and that has been a recent addition or a recent enhancement, I should say, is our communications when it comes to winter maintenance on the sidewalks especially. It's not just messaging anymore about, you know, it's time to move your vehicles. It's also messaging about remember to shovel your sidewalks. Here's what the city policy is. You know, giving videos on multiple social media platforms about how the policies work, how you as a homeowner have a responsibility, and then several other topics including free sand for people this year was another thing that was added as something that we are striving to do everything we can, you know, to make our sidewalks work better. So what's challenging here? This photo has, it's a picture of really just one corner of one intersection, but there's a few challenging things that I can at least identify here. For pedestrians, that's not a very accessible corner yet. And so I think one of our challenges that we'll look at is how do we make these intersections work even better for pedestrians? Another thing has to do with the bicycle realm here. As you can see, some of the freeze-thaw stuff has left that crust. A lot of times that can get left more often on bike lanes or in bike boulevards because there aren't as many automobile tire tracks kind of smushing everything down and clearing everything out of the way. So we do have an additional problem that was identified also recently too by our bicycle advisory committee. That and sort of the messaging too, like, how do we know if this is here? Like, we can't know until we get out there, and then we can get out there and we're slipping and sliding around. That's a major problem. So, as I think has been mentioned a little bit before, some of the bus stops are still an issue. We have many, many bus stops within the city, and you get some of the snow mounds or the windrows that can happen when the plows go by. Also, the picture on the right is kind of depicting there are still weak links. You know, if there's one or two residences on one block where the snow hasn't been cleared on a sidewalk, this is still problematic for people that really need that cleared and are trying to make the entire trip, you know, on foot, or they have, you know, mobility issues and can't easily just go out into the street and avoid this area. So we've been able to look a little bit about what other cities are doing. And I wanted to highlight briefly, the city of Vaughan is a suburb of the city of Toronto, but it has a population that is at least comparable to Minneapolis. They have a city-led snow clearance policy, so we're looking at their city as well as a few other cities in terms of, you know, what does it take? What is their sidewalk mileage? How do they do it? We're looking at other cities, too, that have models that are similar to ours, such as Madison, and see some of the fine tweaks that they do in terms of this example here. They do work as well in terms of clearing windrows out, particularly for their multi-use trails in Madison, as well as they do some work too when it comes to pre-treating some of their roadways, as well as pre-treating some of their sidewalks and some of their multimodal paths. So there's a lot of interesting data that other cities are doing. Obviously, it doesn't always compare apples to oranges, population, the weather. It is a little bit different, but we're able to get a lot of new information from that. As I conclude here, the next steps for this study are we're going to document further our own current practices. Like I said, how does it all fit together? We want to identify and evaluate some of these budget impacts. We want to get to some detailed level that's really going to inform us, all of us as the city of Minneapolis. How can we make this work? How can we make this work better? And we're going to look at some of those different scenarios, you know, in terms of what does the scenario look like for a priority pedestrian network? What does that look like for a priority bicycle network? What does the scenario look like where the city leads some form of sidewalk clearance? We're going to look at different scenarios and see how they all work together and see if we can make this all work together. So I think the big takeaway from this presentation is We just want to make sure that this is continuing to be our focus. Our focus is around people, and it's around people year-round when it comes to getting from point A to point B, and that's exactly how we have our study focused in Minneapolis. So thank you very much.
So Kurt talked about the functional aspects, about the infrastructure and snow clearance and so forth. Our final speaker is Ben Shardlow, and he's with the Downtown Improvement District, and he's going to talk about how Minneapolis is thinking about activating the downtown and making the downtown Minneapolis much more of a winter city. So Ben?
How's everybody doing?
Good.
You're a very quiet crowd. Very, very polite. Ready for just a little bit more content? Okay. So, as my dad mentioned, I'm Ben Shardlow. I'm the Director of Urban Design for the Minneapolis Downtown Council and the Minneapolis Downtown Improvement District. And I'm going to use my time to give kind of a live look in, a hyperlocal look in of how I think we're doing in downtown Minneapolis in terms of being and becoming a winter city. In a candid way, and give a look at a couple of projects that have been recently designed or are being designed now that exemplify designing for winter activity, and then I'll look at kind of some of the key programs and assets and amenities that we have to build from, and then what I see as some opportunity areas. So just to do a level set on the geography that I'm talking about, the Minneapolis Downtown Improvement District is represented with that green boundary. It's about a 120 block area of downtown Minneapolis. That is the Downtown Improvement District, and that organization is funded by the commercial property owners within that district. We have a budget of about $6.5 million that we use for making downtown cleaner, safer, and greener. And then the larger orange boundary, did you call it orange? Orange-red. Is what is embraced by the Minneapolis Downtown Council in the 2025 plan as downtown, and that plan was drafted.
You need to talk toward that microphone too,
please. Okay, I can do that. So a key move in the 2025 plan was to embrace the identity of downtown as not just the CBD. Downtown includes the riverfront, it includes the North Loop, and the great surrounding neighborhoods. So I'll speak to that area as well. So the first project that is being has been designed and is being constructed right now is Nicollet. And this is a look, this is a rendering of a future condition. And to the left is what used to be a department store and will be something else exciting in the future. And it's an illustration not of something, not an exact winter condition that we're going to see, but it exemplifies some of the design features of Nicollet that you'll see when it is constructed. The first, I would ask you to draw your attention to the fact that the walkway is against the building. That was a key design move with a lot of pedestrian space. In the mall, the Nicollet Mall that we're all used to, there was kind of a pedestrian chicane that you would have to do around sidewalk cafes and large fixtures and obstructions. And through some experiments and working with the designers of the Nicollet project now, James Corner Field Operations, we saw that it is true that businesses, retail operations, kind of can induce people to come inside more when those customers are right up against their windows. So in the summer, our sidewalk cafes are going to be out against the curb. And in the winter, that creates a large, flexible space for seasonal activations. So is that going to be colorful lit ice blocks? I don't know. We'll figure that out. But that's one element to note. Another is that the public art and some of the special streetscape fixtures that are being added as part of the project are really emphasizing and embracing light. After hearing Simon's presentation earlier today and kind of everyone else's presentation, I'm so glad we've got that. It's going to be lit in an interesting way. So those kind of globes that you can see on the left side of the screen are more generic versions of what are going to be artist-designed globes with local poets' work illuminating the surrounding street. That's what we're calling the light walk. On the other, or the art walk rather. On the other side, you can kind of see it. You can barely see it through the snow, but isn't it lovely? You can see these large structural steel kind of members that have mirrored fins over them, with LEDs embedded in the structural steel kind of armatures. So what that means is, as you're walking through it, you'll be able to see through a reflection the sky above. And from the skyways looking down, you'll see a different view of the street. So it'll be a really interesting, unique pedestrian experience in all seasons. And it's going to have programmable LEDs through the armature. So this is what you'll see in the center of Nicollet. And then towards the ends of Nicollet, you'll see some of these the same design features and elements, a clear pedestrian walkway next to the building. And then elsewhere, it'll be lit in other ways, but kind of the same general idea. A lot of uplighting of trees to create visual interest in all seasons and in the dark hours. And we're moving away from hanging twinkle lights in trees, because apparently that's not very good for trees, and we want these trees to do really well. So that'll be a change. Another recent project that I wanted to highlight that shows that we have been, as a community downtown, thinking about embracing winter and being active in winter is the Commons, the new park that just opened last year in the Easttown neighborhood. And this is an image of an event that happened earlier this winter that exemplifies, I mean, obviously it looks like a very nice group of people, but the key design direction that I wanted to highlight here is that I think in another era there might have been more of an emphasis in this project and in Nicollet on permanent design features, kind of key focal points that are probably pretty expensive and really beautiful to behold. But the idea with the Commons and with Nicollet is to create a lot more programmable areas that can be flexibly activated in different seasons. So it can be as simple as this area in the Commons is large enough and designed that you can bring in a portable fire pit in winter and create a gathering that's special for that context. And then in the summer, it can be something completely different. And in line with some of what the earlier speakers have mentioned, notably Max, maybe that can lend itself as we kind of grow into this new public space downtown into understanding future capital improvements that could happen once we learn what people actually want to do in the space. So that's the Commons. Next, just a few images of existing programs, activations that exemplify that we're not starting from scratch in terms of being a winter city. I would expect that many of you are familiar with Holidazzle. That's the Downtown Council's seasonal signature winter activation. It's been running in Loring Park for 3 years. There was a gigantic lit up moose this year. And it's quite publicly moved from being something where people come downtown, kind of passively watch a parade, to activating a key existing downtown public space that was not heavily activated in winter, that being Loring Park. So the festival ran between Thanksgiving and Christmas, and it included food vendors, gift vendors, fire pits, outdoor movies. It kind of ran the gamut of seasonal activation. So that's an anchor in that area of downtown. Another awesome activation that happened for the first time this winter was the Great Northern Festival. And this is an image of one of the events that happened through that kind of umbrella festival that brought together the Lopet and the Winter Carnival and the Pond Hockey Championships and others that I'm forgetting. But this was an example where I mean, it's great when you can use capital investments to create new spaces and shape redevelopments to create new spaces that are designed for winter. You can also just shut down a street and have a couple star-studded chefs come in and do an outdoor three-course meal. There are really some amazing photographs of this. So this is on First Street in the North Loop. Another activation that happened through the Great Northern Festival that illustrates a similar thought is, I actually can't see the notes, but I think it was the Words Words for Winter, thank you, Lisa, where in which the kind of for the first time Nicollet as a construction site was used as an opportunity for winter engagement and activation. So what you can see here is the kind of dynamic roadside signage, which for the duration of the festival became an opportunity to show poems by local poets. And candidly, when I heard about that, I was like, oh, that's fine. And then I was walking over the Skyway and I would look down and it was absolutely, I don't know, beguiling. It was so cool to see it reimagined and to see some personality in a space that we're kind of just waiting to become what we all want it to be. So that was really interesting and fun. This is a video. I think the decks are going to be sent out afterwards, so you'll be able to see this. So it's an example of a full poem. Another example of a recent event that just happened that shows one of the benefits of downtown Minneapolis becoming more of a set of residential neighborhoods where people want to make their neighborhoods a better place is this was Winterfest on 2nd Street in the Mill District, and a startup neighborhood group called the Friends of the Mill District just decided, you know, we want to have a festival over here. So they figured it out, they did it, they had horse-drawn carriages, they did kind of a warm winter clothing drive for Youth Link, the farmer's market was open, they worked with their local amenities, drove interest, and had many of the things that Max talked about before with good food, good drinks, and a real sense of place because it was being driven by community residents. This is an image of the first winter activation that was done for the Commons. Happening at the same time as the Great Northern Festival, where the park manager worked with a local artist to create ice lanterns, and they did activations. The image of the fire pit was from this event as well. So that's my snapshot of just a few of the examples of the activations that are happening in downtown Minneapolis. I would say that I would characterize downtown as being in a transition from more of an event mentality to an activation and placemaking and engagement mentality. So I think you can see that through Holidazzle and some of the other events. But now I want to transition into talking about some of the other things, the groundwork that's been laid for further development of our embracing of winter. The development of Green Minneapolis as a multi-site parks conservancy is a really great piece of progress. The Downtown Council helped kind of foster the development and incubate Green Minneapolis, which has gone on to handle the fundraising for the Commons. And as of earlier this year, they are now professionally managing and maintaining and programming the Commons. The person who's in charge of programming the space, Amanda Wiggin, actually came from Bryant Park. She's a Minnesota native, went to Bryant Park. It's been done before. Max? And so the good news is there's a key public space that's been created, but as others have said, it's not just about design, it's about managing the space to be active in winter and programming it in a way that's inclusive and engaging and unique for that area. So Green Minneapolis is kind of a key player, and they're available for hire by property owners to do the same enhanced maintenance, programming, and activation. The second piece of kind of groundwork that I wanted to highlight is not this planter. This is illustrating a concept. The Downtown Improvement District just 2 weeks ago created a new staff role that is being held by Lisa Middag, who's standing right back there, and she asked a question before. And the reason why we reallocated resources to create that role is because we know that just as it's been valuable for the Commons to have someone who's charged with managing that space full time, we know that Nicollet has been designed to be active in all seasons as well. So it is a big task. It's going to be a big task to activate Nicollet. So Lisa has experience from the Walker Arts Center and from Hennepin County activating the Greenway. So she has been brought on to help us figure out how to do that. Because, I mean, I think I managed the winter greening contract when we did this. I don't want to discount the importance of seasonal decorations and streetscaping. But at the same time, this, it was actually kind of hard for me to find bad photos of downtown because we don't keep photos that make us look bad. Funny that. But this is not a particularly vibrant scene. Like, it feels like we can do a lot better in terms of an everyday, active, vibrant, lively space than some greening and planters. Another piece of groundwork that we're doing that can influence how we think about activating sidewalks as a key public space is a GIS tool that we're developing where we're looking at individual sidewalk frontages and using GIS to map activation kind of attributes of those spaces. So this is just an example of the block at 5th and Hennepin where there have been safety concerns, and lo and behold, 2/3 of the frontage is surface parking, and a lot of the remainder is businesses that aren't active at night. There are really only, there's a quarter of the building that's active. So how can we use analytical tools to understand why we aren't seeing more activity in key downtown spaces? Another opportunity area, as Carol alluded to, is we've been working in partnership with Metro Transit to use placemaking as a strategy at downtown bus stops that lack permanent shelters and viewing that as an opportunity. So we've done a series of bus stop pilot projects where we work with artists and designers to create temporary shelters in those stops, and we're eager to expand on that partnership. Another opportunity area is, this is an image of our Minneapolis Big Build campaign. And there's a lot to look at here, but what it's meant to illustrate is that we are seeing a generational level of investment in public space and private space. I learned in our annual meeting last week that the wards that comprise downtown counted, the headlines that have been in paper are that there have been $1 billion of building permits in the city for the last, I believe, 3 years. There was like $1 billion just in the wards that comprise downtown last year. So all of those are opportunities to influence how those spaces are designed, as Simon said earlier, especially from 30 feet down, to make these, to make downtown a more successful winter city. So with that, a few more parting kind of opportunity area thoughts that I wanted to emphasize. One is, I think it's really important for us to build from what we have. So this is an example of that, where In past years, with Helladazzle being in Loring Park, there's been a skating rink that's there for the duration of the festival, and then it goes away. This year, this is a refrigerated rink that's staying in for the entire season. So that's a natural extension of something that we were doing already and just figuring out how to do that logistically. Second opportunity area to highlight, this is, I think, late October, so not a winter image. But it illustrates the point that I wanted to make, which is working in dense urban areas, there are so many layers of jurisdictions and players that it can be really difficult to have complete site control of any area. And it's really difficult to get things done when they're complex, especially when they're on the front page of the paper so often. But I would highlight the commons as an example of how it's important to lean into those jurisdictional tensions and challenges and push through them, because the creation of this park went beyond what was going to happen initially in the early planning stages for the Downtown East project of just a game day plaza that the Vikings were going to own, and it was going to stay vacant all but, 10 days a year, to working through partnerships that required coordination between the state, the county, the city, the park board, the developer, our office, Green Minneapolis, I'm forgetting others, but that's a lot. And by doing that, we've gone from a downtown in which people would kind of tailgate next to their cars and a few streets near the Metrodome to a big space that can work for everyday users, but it also works for creating a different experience for people when they come to events at US Bank Plaza, US Bank Stadium, rather. This is a Trampled by Turtles show, people using the food trucks. I think that exemplifies leaning into those tensions and working through them because you're going to run into them. And the work that we've done with Metro Transit on the bus stop pilot projects would be another example of that. Another opportunity area to highlight before I'm out of time is, this was another, I was trying to look for a picture where we looked bad. This is the closest I could get. I think we need, thank you, Aaron. I think it is not true that we don't, I think there's a general sense that we don't have pedestrians in downtown public spaces and public spaces generally in winter. I don't think that's true. Obviously it goes down, but there are key audience that are still there, and a lot of those plucky people are transit riders. So there are still lots of transit riders out in public spaces, and there are opportunities to engage them, delight them, and recognize that they are us. They are our coworkers, there are visitors, so how can we create an exceptional downtown experience for them as well? So with that, my parting thought is a call to action. I would invite each and every one of you, because we are the winter-loving geeks that we've been waiting for. My challenge to you is to literally this winter go do something. Go be an ambassador for the vision of a winter city that you want to see. Don't wait for approval. This is being recorded. Don't do anything stupid. Do something a little bit stupid, but go try something. Don't wait for a budget that you don't have now. Don't think about next winter. We've still got winter now. If we all go out and do just one thing that's within our power, and talk about some of the ideas we've heard today, I think we'll be one step closer to being the winter city we want to be. So, thanks.
Questions? Yes, over here.
Thanks. So just real quickly, I'm a trans man from the South, and I feel like my experience is really the way to state this, but I ride my bike every day because I choose to, and I have access to gear and resources. And so all of these ideas are really great, and I really think that a lot of them are inherently equity practices, clearing the sidewalk, making sure that people with mobility challenges can get to where they need to go, having access to transit. But I didn't really hear anyone explicitly mention equity, and only one presenter kind of hit upon this idea of multiculturalism. And so when we think about becoming a winner city, how can we really make it a winner city for everyone, not just the people that we saw in the photos in these presentations? So not to be like the negative person, but like, how do we get more people that don't look like us in this room out in these spaces?
Thank you for asking that.
That's definitely an excellent question. I will say that there's been a tremendous amount of emphasis on equity in planning of the transit systems and the corridors and where the stations are, but if any of the speakers would want to.
I think that a big part of the answer lies in not making spaces for people, but creating systems and platforms so people create their own spaces through rules and regulations and, you know, some education maybe, but allowing people to do what comes naturally. I mean, a lot of these things that were programmed and planned and done professionally are just like an acceleration of thing and scaling up of things that people have been doing on their own as human beings for thousands of years. And so what are we doing in terms of how we regulate and who can use and in what way our public spaces, our front yards, our businesses, our sidewalks, our, you know, et cetera, and just allowing people to do the things that they just want to be able to do with it, you know, in a way that doesn't infringe on the use of other people's enjoyment of these same spaces. I think that that's the only way we'll truly create equitable access to like high quality winter spaces, because we frankly will never have enough money to top down program and activate all that we have. We need to rely on just human nature and like the latent resources and abilities of all of us to get that done.
I'll touch on a couple of things Metro Transit's working on. So one thing you may have heard about is the Better Bus Stops program. So what that program is doing, that was a federal grant we were awarded to improve waiting facilities in areas of concentrated poverty. And so, you know, again, providing more shelters and waiting facilities that have light and heat, that's one opportunity. But again, focusing again more on doing a lot more community outreach and engagement that had not been done prior to that in the same way, I guess, that it's being done now. So actively asking the folks that are using the space and using the service, what do you value? What do you want? How can we do better? Goes you know, a long way, and then looking for partnership opportunities again so that, you know, we can leverage what we have, but then also how can we partner again to provide something even more and provide, you know, everyone with the dignity while they're waiting for transit. And then, you know, while you're on board, again, providing that reliable service that is, again, getting you where you need to go in a timely manner when you need to be there.
Other questions? One here and one here.
Hi, my name's Ella. I had a quick question for Ben about that GIS tool that was mentioned. If you could talk a little more about where the data comes from that, or like the extent of that, and if it's an open source tool or something that downtown planning district uses.
Good question. So it was, the data was developed based on the observations of an intern that we had over the summer last year, and we covered a 20-block area to start. So we didn't know of any precedents for it, so we're kind of making it up as we go, but we'd love to work towards it being a tool that's larger in geographic scope and one that could be open, kind of an open data resource, because I think we want to learn more from what other people experience, not only from our own point of view.
So you'd be willing to share it, but it isn't necessarily set up to be an open source database.
Not yet, right.
And question over here. Christina? Anybody could get Christina's eye for the, right over here.
Hi, Michelle Molstead, Master of Minnesota, although I'm speaking not for nice writing. I was just up in Montreal for the Winter Cycling Congress last week. And one of the things that was talked about was the intersection of wellness, both physical and mental wellness, and winter activity. Are those components being discussed, measured? Is there interest in those components by both government and development? Thoughts on that?
Certainly a lot of emphasis on
healthy cities and a lot of discussion about that as this round of comprehensive plans are being done, but that's a good question for Minneapolis, I would think.
I think there's sort of an overarching emphasis on those things. I think particularly within the purposes of the study that I was presenting on, it's really implied that we're looking at health too. I think, again, the study is really focused on transportation, but transportation as health has become a much bigger and broader topic within the city of Minneapolis and within public works as well, so that we are sort of connecting and engaging with all of our different plans. You know, as we work on the winter maintenance study, we are referencing some of these other plans that's going to kind of fit underneath, and one of those has to do with, you know, the health and the I can't think of the other word, but the health and wellness of the city and those sorts of plans that go with the Minneapolis Health Department too. So it would be in conjunction with that, yes.
Other questions? Contributing to Christina's wellness here as she's getting her steps in.
I'm Joey Weitzman with the Woody Reliance Neighborhood Group, and I was curious with some of these programs of activation, how, if we've looked at other cities' policies or plans for people experiencing homelessness in downtown Minneapolis, and how to also be inclusive in that way.
Bill?
Yes. So I lead a group that's working on improving the experience for the roughly 2,000 people who stay in emergency shelter in the vicinity of downtown during the day. So we're working on strategies to get people who are experiencing homelessness better access to transportation resources, better access to storage. So I can speak directly to that, and I'd be happy to talk with you more about this afterwards. Then in terms of the shelter system itself, there's a redesign that just happened over the last year to reduce the amount of waiting that people need to do trying to get into shelter on any given night. People are able to reserve beds a lot more. And then we have a big focus and investment on engagement and outreach. So there is kind of a quiet but really effective group of people that's out on in the streets and the skyways every day in downtown connecting people with resources.
I'm going to take one more question, and then I think all of the speakers will be more than willing to talk to folks offline, and Christine is going to make some final comments. So, final question.
All right, and this may have been stated earlier, but I was just wondering, are the PowerPoints going to be available to the group?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, and I have one statement I want to make that was made just a couple moments ago, and that was about implied connections. I really hate implied connections because what we imply now may not be what somebody reads 10 years from now as an implied connection because thoughts and outlooks change. So I really would recommend that connections not be implied, but that they be implicitly stated.
Thank you.
All right, well, thank you, everyone. I so appreciate all of your time and energy coming out this morning and slightly into the afternoon, so thanks for your extra time as well. Feel free, if you have any questions for any of us, of course, please reach out to myself. You had a few emails with my information on it. I'm Christina Nessie at the TOD office. Otherwise, as John noted, any of the speakers are available and more than willing to speak with you in person or otherwise. So with that, thank you all. And I want to extend a huge thank you to John and his team at Santech, to Carol, I can't quite say thank you to Metro Transit, but thank you, to Ben and the Minneapolis Downtown Improvement District, Kurt and Minneapolis Public Works, Max and John at the Musicant Group. So let's do one final round of applause.